morning and welcome to the 13th meeting of 2024 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. I have received apologies from Gordon MacDonald this morning and Bob Doris is attending as committee substitute. So our first item of business is an agreement to take agenda item 3 and all future consideration of evidence for this inquiry in private. Is that agreed? Thank you. So our next item of business is the first evidence session of the committee's inquiry into the disability employment gap in Scotland. The committee previously undertook some initial work in this area last year, and as part of that, we visited Enable and Dovetail Enterprise in Dundee and the National Autistic Society in Glasgow. This month, the committee welcomed the young people and staff from the usual place in Dumfries and visited the Giraffe Cafe and Push Reuse Centre in Perth on Monday, to hear directly from disabled people and their experiences of accessing the labour market. I'd like to thank all those we have met so far for giving up their time and giving us the benefit of their experience as we begin our inquiry. So this morning we'll hear evidence from two witness panels and we'll focus on employability services for disabled people. May I welcome Elizabeth Baird, who is joining us online. Elizabeth Baird, who is joining us online, representing the Inverclyde Local Employability Partnership. Dave McCallum, Head of Career Information Advice and Guidance Operations with Skills Development Scotland. Philip Ritchie, representing the Edinburgh Local Employability Partnership, and Alistair Scott, representing the Scottish Borders Local Employability Partnership. Thank you all for attending this morning. If members and witnesses can keep their questions and answers focused, we'll make good progress this morning. So could I, first of all, it's a broad opening question. I'll maybe come to Elizabeth first and ask Elizabeth, what progress has been made to reduce the barriers for disabled people to access and retain mainstream employment? In Scotland, we have a commitment from the government to close the disability employment gap, and part of this inquiry is scrutinising whether we're on track to do that. So I could have your reflections on what progress has been made.
Hi there. Yes, I do think progress has been made. I think we still have some way to go, and it's encouraging that we are continually learning lessons from putting some processes and practices in place, also continuing to gather the lived experience input, which is very important for us going forward. And I think the LEP process and the systems that the LEP and the partners that it brings together enables us to really focus on where are we not meeting our requirements and what can we do to improve that. But that it needs to be done collectively, and I genuinely think that all the local employability partnerships are working towards that.
Mm-hmm. And is there, do you see, are there particular groups of people that are not making as quick progress, or is there...
Those with a disability, and it's in its broadest sense, we, I know the committee's also touched on the health barriers to employment, which obviously with the pandemic we're seeing more people with stress and anxiety. But if we look at those with a disability, whether that be a learning disability or a physical disability, then yes, the progress there is probably slower than we would want. But it's not a new issue for us within employability. These are always clients who we wish to support in the longest journey possible for them, and it's a very bespoke journey. So, yes, I do think that the disabled client base, but we don't want to leave behind those who have a health barrier. We want to prevent them from becoming the long-term unemployed of the future.
Mm. If I now maybe come to Philip Ritchie. Philip's here from Edinburgh Council, and you're representing Edinburgh Local Employability Partnership. So, I suppose the same kind of question to you: where do you think there's been progress, and do you feel that we're on target to meet the government's commitment to close the disability employment gap?
Yeah, I think in terms of an Edinburgh context, we're in quite a good place in terms of delivery. I think there's been quite a transformation in terms of employability over the past few years in terms of bringing various programmes together under that No One Left Behind banner. And I think alongside that, we've also got our local provision as well. And I think specifically for those with a disability, we've got a really successful support employment model delivery in Edinburgh. I think that goes a long way in terms of supporting the client group and what's needed. So I think from an Edinburgh perspective, we've got a good model there alongside the other local provision that's available as well.
Mm-hmm. And has there been anything recently that's made you know, that's improved the offer that you have? Is there, because one of the, we're thinking about, does the government understand where it needs to do more, and are they introducing the right policy measures in order to address those challenges?
Yeah, I think North West Behind is obviously a very wide-ranging kind of policy, so I think it's about looking at that and making sure that it is covering this scenario in terms of the disability employment gap and actually making sure that it's meeting those needs as well. I think, you know, in terms of the resources, I think that's a key issue in terms of making sure those resources are there to support what's needed. And I think it's about recognising that it's a significant resource that's required. And I think, you know, the more resources available, the more we're able to achieve.
Mm. And do you find that there's within a group of disabled people, there's different kind of abilities or different kind of challenges that people face? Do you find there's groups of people who it's harder to make progress with and we need to put more focus on? Or
I think in terms of our service that we offer in Edinburgh, it's a pan-disability service, so there's kind of not that kind of focus on specific disabilities. It's kind of all disabilities we would support and those with long-term health conditions. So we don't kind of separate out in terms of that aspect of our delivery of our service. So I think, as I would say again, you know, it's about that. The more resource we've got, the more we're able to deliver. So I don't think we would. I think there's obviously going to be differences in terms of how people are supported, and some will take longer depending on their circumstances. But in terms of what we try to offer in Edinburgh, it's an all disability service.
Yeah. I'm going to come to Alistair. And Alistair, you're here from Scottish Borders Council. Let's just kind of build on the questions we've had so far, because some of the research that's been done by Fraser of Allendar says that while the government are making progress on closing the gap, people with neurodivergent conditions and people with learning disabilities, it's a slower progress in that group of people, and there's more difficulties in getting them into work. Is that something that Scottish Borders, when you think about the strategy you have, is that an area you're focused on, or is it a broader approach to the issue?
Sorry. It is what we're focused on. I think, like Philip said, we're a pan-disability, so we're caring for everyone. There are certain projects we have in place to focus on those with neurodivergent conditions. Project Search, for example, which is a well-known project that specifically for those with learning disability or additional support needs, autism. So that's an example of good practice, I would say. So I think we do focus directly on specific disabilities, but we, you know, in a broader sense, we cater for everyone, as the No One Left Behind is set out to do. But as in the borders, I would say we're more aligned now than we ever were in terms of collaboration with other organisations and services to hopefully meet the demand and make more of an impact.
As I said earlier, the committee did have a look at this last year. One of the issues we identified there was concerns around unmet need. So while there are, do you know, I think all the organisations can talk about how many people are being supported in the border, do you think there's an unmet need out there, and what's kind of done to reach out to people or to identify people? And
yeah, we're out in the community a lot more, so we're trying to engage with people that maybe wouldn't access services previously. Or has access to support, so that there's certainly people out there that will not have access to services or maybe not engaging with people, so it's how we reach them. So there's a lot of work going on across the region. The borders is, as you're probably aware, that a rural setting, so there's limited resources in terms of service provision. Out with the local authority, third sector is relatively small in the borders, so we're doing what we can to support that growth, so we can reach those people that maybe aren't engaging, the same as others.
Mm-hmm. I now come to Dave McCallum. So Dave, the original question was about barriers faced by disabled people to access and retain mainstream employment. If you maybe reflect on that, but also around government policy and measures, do you feel that they're on the right path, that they're bringing the policy interventions they're bringing in, are they the right ones, and are there enough?
I mean, my team's responsible for delivering career information advice across Scotland, and we work very closely with our partners out here today and other third sector organisations across the 32 local authorities. We're an all-inclusive service, so we'll support individuals who, from school age all the way up FEHE and beyond, But we'll help them to identify kind of the support they need or to identify their skills to move into employment. But also we'll link in with our local employability partners to see what provisions are available to move those customers onto the appropriate provision to support them into a sustained kind of destination. That can be challenging at times because that provision can vary across the 32 local authorities. And also we need to make sure that the 32 local authorities and the communities that we serve is bespoke and the opportunities are bespoke. So they will be different, but sometimes it can be challenging to identify the appropriate provision to support people to move on. But the partners do work closely together to ensure that we are providing the right support, because it's not just on one service, it's how we all work together to support those individuals into employment.
And you described the service as being an inclusive service. Do you find when it comes to supporting people with disabilities, and you also talked about it being bespoke, so how as an organisation do you try to make sure that you can serve, you know, you can provide support for everybody who comes in regardless of what type of disability they have? And is that more working with partners than yourself? Or?
No, I mean, everything we do is in partnership, but we are responsible for making sure that all school-aged children and moving on to transition into a destination, be that further education or employment, we provide them with the appropriate support, working with schools, etc. And we offer a targeted, so everybody's is entitled to career information, advice and guidance, but within our school-aged children, we work with the schools and the practitioners in the schools to identify those who maybe have the greatest need to make sure they're getting the right support to move forward. But also if we have people in a post-school situation, we'll work with them and partners to make sure that we're providing them with the right support to move forward. So everything we are doing to try and support those individuals is inclusive, but also we recognise that sometimes that advice and guidance might not be the appropriate support, and we need to work with our partners to get that individual to the right place to take on those opportunities.
Because as I said at the beginning, we've met with particularly young people who, so we've met people with lived experience. Most of the experience of school hasn't been very positive, or their experience of leaving school or transitions hasn't been very positive. Do you think that's an area that we're letting young people down with neurodivergent conditions and learning disabilities?
I think there's always opportunities that all partners can do to improve. Nobody's ever perfect, but I think working with schools, we work very closely with guidance teachers and teachers to make sure that we're identifying through our kind of needs matrix approach to make sure that those individuals and schools are getting the right support as they go to transition onto next to new opportunities. So I'm pretty confident we work in that. We have partnership agreements with our schools to make sure that we've got those right mechanisms in place to support those individuals. And of course, there's always maybe the odd teething challenge within a school or what the opportunities are going into FE or HE, but we work very closely with partners to overcome them. Because we are part of that solution, but we're not the only solution.
I'm going to bring Kevin Stewart in before I bring in Colin Smith.
Just a wee supplementary on that, convener. Talking to young folk last week, they definitely had a difficulty with school. That those young folk were from Dumfries and Galloway. However, I have to say that you talked about further and higher education, and one of the things that all of those young folk that Mr. Smith and I talked to last week said was that they felt that college was a bit of a tick box exercise as far as the college was concerned, and that they were not listened to. Can you tell us how you work with higher education partners to make sure that these young folk are listened to and that they are able to fulfil their hopes and aspirations? A very articulate bunch of folk we spoke to last week who had a strength of feeling, which, you know, they put across very well about not being listened to in higher education.
I mean, I can't speak for FE and HE, but what I can say is that our team work very closely with the schools to support that transition. We do have partnership agreements in place with colleges, for example, and we would, and where there's individuals who need additional support, we'll help them with that transition to hand them over to our college partners. bit to provision in colleges and what happens in colleges, I can't make comment in that because the FE sector is different across Scotland.
This, because obviously you have a job to do in terms of helping folk move on and hopefully move on to work. How often do you and other partners actually ask for these folks' opinions about how they have been served, how have they have been treated on that journey?
We ask them all the time. So after every appointment with a careers advisor, we'll ask them to fill in a survey. We'll contact young people who have recently transitioned and left school. We'll do a young person survey around about August time, but I can provide all this information to you. So we're always looking for our pupils' voice and our customers' voice to understand how we can make the appropriate changes to our services in order to serve our customers. But I can provide all that to committee.
Thank you.
Taking evidence from College of Scotland later in the coming weeks. Colin Smith to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. Almost every business I speak to at the moment tells me about the recruitment challenges they have, struggling to fill vacancies, particularly in some of the rural areas. Alistair, at the Borders and Dumfries and Galloway, where I'm based. Yet at the same time, we have this significant disability employment gap. We have this huge group of potential employees that are not getting the opportunity. So why is it that we appear to be failing to make the business case for closing the disability employment gap? What is it that businesses seem reluctant to maybe take on people that have a particular disability? What we're failing to do? Easy question to kick off that Wednesday morning, I'm sure. Tell us the answer. I mean, it's interesting, Alistair, you, in the Borders, the figure, I mean, it's interesting because I'm based in Dumfries and Galloway and the gap's bigger than Dumfries and Galloway than it is in the Borders. I don't know if, I mean, I don't know if it's that praising you or anything because you've still got big challenges there, but I mean, what is it? Is there something in the Borders that businesses are grasping that we're not doing in other parts of the country? I mean, you've still got a gap there. So what is it? What is it? Businesses are not seeing those opportunities, I suppose.
I suppose in the Borders, there's a lot of small micro businesses that contributes to that. I think there's aspects such as travel in the rural area contributes to that, and having the right job for the right person in an area where they abode. So there's those challenges that always have been, to be honest with you. So the Chamber of Commerce sits in our local employability partnerships, we're working close with them, and through our LEP we've made quite a lot of headway over the last year in terms of that focus. In terms of those with disabilities moving into employment, we offer key worker support, so every individual has a key worker to look at their strengths and attributes to try and navigate around what opportunities are out there for them that's achievable. And part of that is going to do employer engagement, often with the employers in the area, to see if we can get an opportunity. It might be a work trial, it could be whatever tool we have to use, we'll use to try and support them. There are challenges in the rural area, without a doubt. But those are something that we're trying to tackle as a whole region. Other than working in silos individually, we're working across the local employability partnership as a network to try and improve opportunities.
And are businesses feeding back as to why maybe they're not grabbing all the opportunities that you're proposing around support for some of the people who get into employment?
I think there's work to be done there, to be perfectly honest with you. We recently had an employer jobs fair, a local job centre, for employers that had vacancies, and we had, I think, about 250 people attend, clients attend that event. It was in Gala Shields, it was central based for transport ease, I suppose. So we're waiting to see what the outcome of that was in terms of how many people moved on into employment from that, or in what engagement was made.
I'm assuming Phillips the same challenges in Edinburgh. I mean, you don't have the geographical challenges around getting from, I don't know, Hoyt to Gala Shields or something like that, you know, but so what? Why do you think the businesses that have got all these vacancies appear to be often reluctant to give those opportunities?
I think that matching process when someone has a disability is obviously much more complex in terms of opportunities that we have and incentives we have for employers to try and encourage them to recruit from those that we are supporting and working with. And I think sometimes bringing together those kind of needs and support requirements can be quite challenging and difficult. And I think there's work to be done there to improve that kind of process to make it smoother. And I think that just improves as kind of, you know, there's more kind of technology comes on board and employers become more aware of the kind of ways they can make adjustments and things. And I think there's way to go in terms of that. And I think there's obviously that kind of training piece and that awareness raising with employers. And we've been trying with our partners to do that kind of employer engagement and raise much more awareness with employers so they don't see that as being a barrier and are willing to make those kind of leaps of faith for those that have a disability to give them that opportunity and support. So I think we are kind of, that's got a way to go, but I think we are making inroads into that with employers. But obviously it's a slow process in terms of that kind of changing culture within workplaces.
Elizabeth, is the same experience in Inverclyde? You know, why are we not getting that message across about the business case to lots of businesses?
Yes, it is a similar situation in Inverclyde. One of the things I would say, though, is that while we all across the LEPs have employer engagement as part of our provision, and we are reasonably successful at it, I do think that's an element where we do need to focus, and some policy or input there would be helpful in terms of looking at the longevity of employer engagement to take the burden off the employer as much as possible in terms of identification of potential suitable roles within their workforce, and also some support ongoing in terms of the supervision and the releasing of current staff to be able to really have an impact on the roles that we would be able to make available to people with a disability in the initial stages. But also there's an element of potential kind of a bit of fear from employers about the unknown. And if we can provide professionalism on an ongoing basis to support them, I would imagine we would be more successful in terms of moving people with a disability into fair work.
David, I don't know. I mean, you'll see the pattern right across the whole of Scotland. I mean, and there is clear variations in different parts of Scotland. Is there variations from your experience around support that people get in from an employer's point of view? Is there anything that Skills Development Scotland can bring to break down some of these challenges that people are talking about? It seems to me that it's that follow-up support, it's that when somebody does go into a workplace, it's supporting the business, if you like, or is it getting them into the workplace in the first place is the challenge?
I think sometimes that the challenge is getting them into the workplace. We work very closely with the 32 local employability partnerships, and I would say the majority of local employability partnerships try to put provision on to provide opportunities for employers to take customers on who are maybe neurodiverse or disabled. And some challenges, that can be challenging in some rural locations due to just transport, etc. So we will work very closely with the LEPs when we're working with our customers and wider partners to try and support our customers into the appropriate opportunity. And it does vary from across the 32 local authorities, 32 LEPs.
Do businesses get the business case for this? Is there a piece of work to be done around that?
I think there's businesses out there that really want to help, and we see that. We work with our DWP, DYW partners, and they do employability fairs, and they work with employers. We've got our own teams who will go out and do employer engagement sessions with our other internal teams in SDS. So we're always trying to kind of highlight the opportunities of the skills and attributes that our customers can bring to their workforce, and we'll always consider to do that. It's definitely a partnership approach in how we work together and put that provision in place to support those individuals.
Oh, sorry, thank you. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Mayor. There's a couple of areas around employers' input here that I'd like to explore a little bit. You've already touched on some of these areas. But the actual recruitment process within employers, how can it be improved? I mean, you've already got a partnership with some employers, but let's look at the generality, because not all employers have that partnership with you. How can your average employer improve the recruitment process for disabled people? Dave, maybe you'd...
I think there's plenty of examples, if we take it from a school perspective, and colleges that ourselves, working with LEPS, DYW, we're bringing employers in to speak to young people and young adults to help them what that looks like coming in to see what the process is to get various different jobs and what the employer's looking for. But the thing is, the benefit there isn't just to the individual who's meeting the employer, but it's also to the employer and learning what these young people and young adults are bringing to the table. So there's definitely those activities happening across Scotland, and I think that happening is kind of changing maybe some of the ways employers look to go out and recruit.
Well, interestingly, you know, we had this roundtable with young people last week, which was really informative. None of them actually referenced employers coming in and having any meaningful discussion with them. And it was overall, from the ones I spoke to, it was a fairly negative experience. Philip, maybe you've got a comment there.
Yeah, definitely got a comment on that, because that's quite disappointing to hear that's been their experience. I think certainly from the LEP in Edinburgh, we've got obviously developing the young workforce, and they're doing significant work with schools, and that's both special schools and mainstream schools in terms of supporting them with that employer engagement piece and having industry come into to schools and have those conversations about potential opportunities when they leave. So there's definitely significant work happening there with Edinburgh. I can't comment on other local authorities, but certainly we see a lot of work happening with that employer engagement piece. Going back to the kind of the recruitment piece, I think there's definitely work to be done there with employers to look at kind of more innovative ways of recruiting, and that's what we try to do as part of our kind of employer engagement, is to look at, you know, is there other ways they could recruit, whether that's about kind of work trials or whether it's about looking at kind of different ways rather than kind of the traditional kind of standard interview process, because that doesn't work for those with a disability. It's not really a kind of fair process for them. So there needs to be more adjustments to that kind of process. And as I say, one of the things we do is look at kind of volunteering and work trials and placements and that kind of paid placements in terms of those incentives for employers to actually look at how they can give someone a chance before they kind of take that next step in terms of a permanent post.
Just following on from that, I mean, obviously you want workplaces to be inclusive and so on, and you want any adaptations and so on that are needed done for the person who's hopefully going there. If they're going for a short-term placement, to what extent would you expect employers to make these adaptations and changes to accommodate the person?
That has to be the case, because it's not possible otherwise. So we've looked at different ways we can provide those resources through either access to work schemes or whether it's through other resources that we have through other funding to be able to make those adjustments, because I think that's required and necessary.
Provide funding, at least if there's some physical
absolutely
changes needed.
Absolutely.
Alistair?
Yeah, I think we're key workers are key to looking at trying to path a way in there to employers, you know, pave a way in there, so that, you know, they often look at work experience as a good working example. Is the job suited to you? Find out a wee bit more about the job. We have used employer recruitment incentives in the back of that to allow people to get time to get trained up and the ability to do the job. Often, a lot of, you know, people with sometimes people with disabilities might not manage or cope well with interview scenarios depending on their condition, mental health issues, confidence, whatever it may be. So sometimes we do have to look at an alternative. But I think a lot of it in terms of changing mindsets of employers is all about relationships. You know, I think there's a lot of work needs to be done in terms of building relationships with employers and them understanding the difference we're trying to make to people's lives and hopefully offer opportunities and willing to discuss options.
These employers, is there any common theme as to the size or type of employer that is more amenable to taking on disabled people?
I think certainly from our experience, there's a kind of range of employers that are involved with our services, and I don't think there is a kind of theme. I think it depends on the kind of willingness of that employer and their willingness to kind of be supportive and accommodate whatever the adjustments that are required that's needed. So I don't think there is a particular theme from our side of things.
So there's no linkage to size or, you know, the ability to absorb that?
No, I don't. I think, obviously, a smaller business has got resource implications, so there'll be a lot of smaller businesses that would struggle in terms of that resource piece. But I think, you know, we still see lots of small employers engaged with our services and willing to help us with what we're doing.
Elizabeth, maybe I can ask you for a comment.
Yes, I think it's similar. I would like to highlight the DYW input that we have within Inverclyde, working along with education and the college, and that has proven successful in terms of the kind of school transitions, providing opportunities where employers have come in to college and into schools and provided talks, also out on visits to workplaces, just to make that industry kind of more real to the young people. And that's across the board for those with disability and those without disability. Certainly the kind of physical adaptations, the access to work is process is very useful. And yes, adaptations do have to be done, even if it's on that kind of shorter term, for to allow work trials, but it's still very important. And it also gives you that in with that employer to look at the kind of longer term ability to increase the disability workforce within their own workplace. In terms of, we have used employer recruitment incentives fairly successfully, and probably majority of LEPs have over the last few years, providing some financial incentive for an employer to look at the disabled clients as a source of recruitment. However, yeah, recruitment processes do need to be changed. Not everyone performs well at a standard interview, we know that, and especially people with neurodiversity and sometimes physical disability. So we are working towards improving how we, but it's about how we support the employer rather than expecting the employer to do that themselves. I do think that we do need to support the employers more to identify what roles are available within their specific workplace, and to give them the confidence that if they start on this journey with us and with the disabled person, that we aren't going to go away anytime soon. We are there for the beginning of the process and we'll be there at the end of the process. However, obviously, funding plays a part in that and the longevity of the funding.
Just to pick up on some references that several of you have made to working in partnership with, like, the DWP, the job centres and all the rest of it, do we have any understanding of disabled people's experience, actual first-hand experience of dealing with these agencies? Because just referring back again last week to the young people we met, they were, the ones I spoke to were unanimous that they felt that the experience that they had at Job Centre DWP were less than good because they did not understand the person that they were dealing with. And, you know, people we were dealing with had various degrees of autism and so on, but they were sort of just parked and pushed aside, was what they felt. Is that the kind of experience that we've got any data on? Do we have an understanding, actually firsthand, as to how this is working? Dave, maybe I can ask you.
Yeah, we have our own data that I could provide that we ask the customers that we support. And I can also double-check what our apprentices are saying, both FA and ME, from their experience with employers. But just on that, just to go back to your last question, if you don't mind, how we support employers is also that we offer apprenticeships for the people with a disability up to the age of 29, recognising that they maybe go into the workplace a wee bit longer. But what we have also noticed that year on year, we started to see an increase in those with additional support needs, a disability increase in both in FAs and MAs. That dropped back slightly during the pandemic, but that's just the realisation that that some the majority or some disabled people with a disability work within the hospitality sector, and that was kind of hit hard during COVID. But we do try to survey and get feedback back from those who either get guidance from us or enter into an apprenticeship programme. But I can provide some more information to the committee.
Interesting, I'm sure. Philip, what's the experience been in your area?
So I couldn't really comment in terms of what DWP would say in terms of their scenario, but I would expect, you know, in terms of the kind of DWP role, they're kind of almost triaging those that are coming to see them, and then
any feedback from disabled people who have experienced?
It's certainly not something that's come up in discussion with our partners in terms of their delivery with disabled clients. So it's not something that's been flagged up as an issue in terms of our area. As I say, the kind of process in terms of how it usually work is usually there would be specialist support that's been put in place by DWP, so it wouldn't necessarily be DWP themselves that would be delivering that support. So that may be where the frustration lies in that kind of onward referral process is maybe not as smooth as it could be. So that's my only kind of explanation of why there may be that kind of frustration from those that you've spoken to.
Also,
yeah, I've not got anything evidence-wise other than hearsay, you know, in terms of maybe some people have struggled more than others with engagement and with maybe interaction. But what we do, we pick people up when they come, you know, to the service to ensure that they're getting that wraparound support that people need. But I've not got anything data-wise to say that's a big issue or not.
It doesn't seem to be a specific data that's being collected.
No. But I'm aware of, certainly in the borders.
Elizabeth?
I'm not aware if we're collecting. I'm sure DWP colleagues do have a mechanism for recording customers' satisfaction and what have you, but I do kind of think that the key worker support that we have within the employability pipeline could maybe aid that so that the individual always has that one point of contact, but it just depends at what point in their journey. If maybe their interaction with the job centre is the first point of contact, then that will change when we move them into the employability pipeline and they're provided with a key worker. But I'm sure certainly locally we would have some statistics on the disability clients of the local job centre and what the satisfaction rate was. I'm sure lessons are learned as well as we try to do across our provision. But I could ask for that information and provide it to committee.
Again, that would be interesting. Thank you, Vina.
Thank you. Just before I bring in Maggie Chapman, Colin Beattie has referred a bit to data, and it does feel in Scotland we're good at sometimes at starting initiatives, but we're not really sure which ones are working, so we don't know where to focus our resources or where to make the best progress, especially when we're trying to tackle something as difficult as the disability employment gap. So I'm wondering where, you know, if as organisations, how you define and measure what is successful. And then the Scottish Government established the Employability Shared Measurement Framework quite recently. Do you feed information into that framework? Do you want to, I've come to Philip.
Yeah, so in terms of that data gathering piece through No One Left Behind, we gather all our data in terms of all our delivery, and that then is fed back into the Scottish Government as part of our delivery. But in addition to that, we've also got our Support and Employment Service, which is not part of that delivery. It's not funded through that route at the moment. So we collect our own data as well in terms of that delivery. So that informs, you know, what we're delivering to make sure it's the right thing in terms of achieving those outcomes and making that impact that we want to make with the resources that we have available. So, you know, we kind of measure that on the basis of, you know, what we get in terms of that investment and what's the impact of that. I think in terms of what we're delivering, going back to what was discussed earlier, I think there's more that we could do if we had more resource. And I do think there's probably that unmet need there in terms of an Edinburgh perspective, in terms of what we're delivering, but we're kind of delivering what we can within the resource we have, and the data showing that what we're delivering is the right thing, and it's working well and having good outcomes for those with disability in terms of that service.
And maybe Alistair, if you want to comment on that as well, because some of the figures that, you know, that are published, whether it's on the Fair Work, I can't remember what the previous scheme was called, now it's No One Left Behind. Some of the figures on retention, so people get into employment, but the amount of people that are still in employment 4 weeks, 8 weeks, a year later, it does start to tail off. Is that is your data Fair telling Scotland. You, is that Fair Start Scotland? Yes. But also some of that data is around the No One Left Behind, though there's been some issues raised around the difficulty of transparency around No One Left Behind funding. But are you, as a local authority, also kind of monitoring and working out what works? And are you feeding into the shared framework, the measurement?
Yeah, absolutely. We feed in quarterly as well, as Philip mentioned. And we do keep our data. I think that we don't see it. I think we're quite successful at sustaining employment for people when they go in, because we put a lot of work in early on to ensure we understand individual, the right supports in place for them. So, you know, we spend a lot of time with people to ensure that we know what needs they have and what support they need when they do go into work, and we support the employer as well with that. And I think that's key. The employer and knows that there's support available for them throughout that process, and it's ongoing. It's always there. We have that wraparound support, so we'll always be in contact with the employer and the person that goes into work to ensure that they don't fall off. You know, there might be a blip here or there that people maybe struggle with work at times, and they need additional support, and we're always there for them in terms of that key worker approach. So we do feed in today, but I think we're quite successful in terms of retention of jobs when we actually move people in. I think it's all about matching the right job for that person and for that individual. So we follow a five-stage process, which is a sort of traditional support employment process. And a lot of it's done in terms of, for the very start, that engagement, vocational profiling, knowing where their skills, where their needs are, where the barriers are. Really understanding the individual. It takes a little bit of time, but it pays dividends, I think, in the long term to ensure that we get the right outcome for them.
Okay, thank you. I'll bring in Maggie Chapman, followed by Myrtle Fraser.
Thanks very much, Ken. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning and for what you've said so far. I want to pick up on drill down and try to understand a bit better, because you all do phenomenal work. You know, they're clearly good examples of success, of getting people into work, sustaining them, supporting them in that employment. And I've heard comments about, you know, the need for sustained and sustainable funding, and we've talked a little bit about data. And yet, given all that, the disability employment gap still remains stubbornly high. And I suppose I've got a question around, and it links to Claire's question around, you know, are we measuring the right kinds of things? But also, how are we missing people who maybe should be getting support? How do we make sure we reach more people, I suppose, essentially, is what I'm asking. And I don't know, Philip, if you want to kick things off, and then I'll come to others.
I think this year's going to be a bit of a transformation year again. We had No One Left Behind came into place 2019. Obviously, there's been a few phases of that, and we're now at the stage where Fair Start Scotland's come to an end. And a lot of those with a disability were getting support from Fair Start Scotland. So I think this will be a bit of a transformation year again in terms of how that then transfers into kind of local services and what the changes are there. So I think this is going to be kind of crucial to kind of really measure and see how we manage to engage with those that previously would have engaged with Fair Start Scotland. Then your referrals will become through to us, and how we manage to get those people engaged in our services. And my hope is that because we're offering really person-centred local services, I think we'll have good engagement levels with what we've got on offer. And I think the challenge will be how we meet that resource to make sure we've got enough resource there to be able to meet that need.
You would say it's primarily a resourcing issue rather than anything to do with structures or anything like that?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we've got good structures, certainly from an Edinburgh perspective. Okay. I think we've got good structures in place. I think we've got the right partners around the table. And I think we've got the kind of right mechanisms and levers that are needed to be able to support those with a disability.
Okay. And Alistair, if I can come to you, same kind of question.
Yeah, I think in the borders we're in a good place right now in terms of local employability partnership and the members we have around there. And we're more aligned, as I said earlier, than we ever were in terms of how we're going to tackle these issues as a collective. I do think that, you know, a lot of it comes down to the yearly funding, to be honest with you, in terms of sustaining staff. We spend a lot of time training staff up and skilled staff and what have you, but the year-on-year funding it plays a big issue in that, and ensuring that we can keep our trained staff. And again, I suppose this year that's another challenge again for us.
Okay. Thanks, Alistair. Elizabeth, can I come to you? Same kind of question around how we make sure we actually do make the most of what you're telling us is a good system.
Yeah, I think the system has certainly improved, and I think the No One Left Behind approach is the correct one, and I think the LEPs across all 32 geographic areas have worked really hard to sit round the table and be quite honest and open about where our specialisms are, where our gaps are, what can we do about those gaps, and obviously disability. It's still an issue, but it has been an issue for, I've been working in employability for 35 years, and it's still kind of, it's moved slightly, but it's still an issue. And as I say, I think certainly to improve things, we've got good structure, we've got good partnerships locally. We want to work together, which is very important. We don't want to deliver everything ourselves. We procure and commission to get experts into the process. But genuinely, the annual funding makes it extremely difficult to do that with any level of quality and without feeling that we are doing good works, but we know it's going to tail off and we're going to have to then re-establish rather than having a cohesion there within the funding stream. However, we know that's not always within certain people's gifts, and we do the best we can. But I genuinely believe the No One Left Behind and the LEP partnership approach is the correct one.
Okay. Thanks, Elizabeth. David, if I can come to you. You obviously get a whole Scotland picture, given the work that you do with all 32 local authorities. How is it that... What are we missing in this?
We've got great mechanisms in place, but there is challenges. So we're responsible for the 16-plus data hub, which tracks young people up to the age of 19, and we report that back to Scottish Government, and that's a great mechanism. Not going into detail, I can provide more information, but if one of our customers to drop out of FE school or not go into a positive destination, we can respond as the career service and across the partnerships. We also work with the LEPs beyond that, so we identify when people kind of drop out and how we can deploy resources, but those resources are challenging for our local employability partners, and sometimes that provision isn't in place. We are responsible for careers information, advice and guidance. We deliver the Modern Apprenticeship Programme. But employability services were moved across to the local authorities back in 2021, I can't remember the exact date. But the key thing is the partnership, and as our colleague there, Elizabeth, said, it's always remained a challenge, but the partners are trying their best to kind of work with the resources we've got to ensure that we have got that safety net there to support our customers within their communities. But they can always, we always put out there the opportunities to contact through ourselves, through our helpline, through our centres, through our community venues we operate in. And also we have staff who are based in some job centres across the country, so we do a bit of kind of handover there as well. So we're doing everything we can to make sure that safety net's there, but unfortunately there is those that we miss at times as a partnership.
I suppose I'm interested in... It sounds like, you know, you've got a good tracking mechanism and good processes for if somebody does drop out, if somebody has a wobble, you can come in and then offer. But how does somebody get into that? How much of that requires proactive sort of searching from the individual, from the young person themselves or their family or support worker or whoever? And is there something that we actually aren't... Because as we've heard already, there were folk we spoke to last week that didn't really know what support was out there, and they kind of fell into support kind of by accident or by chance, I suppose. And that's not really the situation we want to be in.
And that's a shame that was the feedback you got. But we are there. I mean, it's out. We spread across the partnership. We use community planning partnerships as well. We're a statutory partner there. Our WEPs feed into the CPPs. We have local outcome improvement plans, where it's targeted key areas. We will, as a partnership, our WEPs ourselves kind of work to see how we can maybe enhance provision in those areas. We also know ourselves recently from the recent careers review, it was taken out of the careers provision across Scotland, that we're trying. We, as an organisation, we're making sure that we're meeting recommendation, the career service that we're delivering within those communities. So we're doing our best to, as a partnership and ourselves, to make sure that People can contact us through the partners, through our My World of Work website, through our contact centre, and through visiting our community venues and centres. And we have a presence in pretty much every major town across Scotland, yeah. And with our partners.
And I suppose that then enables you to deal with the tension that we've already identified this morning, that tension between that kind of inclusive, you know, open service for everybody and the bespoke needs. Do you feel that they can be, and I know others might want to come in on specific sort of specific areas of needs or groups of disabled people with specific needs, but do we have the agility, I suppose, to say come all, but here's a bespoke service for you?
Hey, we're there to support everybody, and if they come asking for support, we will provide that support. Right. And if that support comes overwhelming in a particular area, then we'll redeploy our resources to make sure that those individuals get the support they require from our own service, and I'm pretty confident that would be the same across our partners as well.
Okay. And my final question, if I may, and it's an open question for any of you, I think that there are clearly really good things happening in your different areas and in your different work. How do we learn from each other? How do you share? You know, this is working really, really well. Hey, over there, have you tried this? This might help. Is it through Dave that the LEPs share good practice? How is it that we can actually learn across the country?
I think he's probably just thinking about, we've got an event next week for our region where we're actually coming together as 6 local authorities to look at sharing best practice and exactly that, so we can, you know, share those examples in terms of what we're doing. And one of the items to look at is actually around about supporting those with disabilities. So, you know, that's something we're doing locally. But I think nationally as well, we've got a Slade conference coming up with all the local authorities coming together to share good practice examples in terms of delivery as well. So I think there's regular opportunities for that, and there's been various, we've got weekly, fortnightly meetings with other local authorities to be able to look at kind of particular issues and gaps and how we meet those and challenges in terms of delivery of what's actually happening. So there's good kind of national mechanisms where we're sharing best practice and meeting with each other to discuss any challenges and issues. So I think there are opportunities for that.
Okay.
And one of the things we do as part of that reporting process to Scottish Government is we provide them with case studies and examples of our delivery as well. So that's done on a quarterly basis to be able to show good practice in terms of what's being delivered in each area. So every local authority provides that to Scottish Government.
Thanks, Philip. I know Elizabeth wanted to come in on this point as well. Go ahead, Elizabeth.
Hi, thank you. I do think the communication is key between the 32 local authorities. We have a fortnightly meeting on Teams, and that has really beneficial in terms of lessons learned, good practice, sharing some frustrations, and it really does help those within the employability arena, within the local authority, to stay focused and to stay positive when the challenges appear, and as I say, to learn from each other, and that will continue, and it's a really great mechanism. And on top of that, we have each LEP will meet probably every 6 to 8 weeks, and that's where the partnership formally gets together. But the informal daily working arrangements that we have with SDS colleagues, with DWP, with the college, that is just an inherent part of the No One Left Behind approach. We all need each other on the ground at operational level, yeah, as well as having a strategic input. So those forums and that way of working is very important. It's very positive. But we also have the formal mechanism of reporting in quarterly to Scottish Government in terms of what money we've spent, what we've achieved with that money, what the successes have been, what the challenges have been. So there is that more formal mechanism also.
Okay. And Dave, you want to come in?
Just to reiterate what the partner said, but we've got some recent examples. We've worked with Scottish Government Improvement Services, LEP managers from across how we support LEPs to do their data return back to Scottish Government. But also we've got area managers from the Career Service that sit in the 32 local employability partnerships, and they'll work together to kind of identify what's going well, what's not going well, and how we can use our resources to support each other. So it is very much a partnership in how we respond to support our communities and customers across Scotland.
Thanks very much for that. Thanks.
Murdo Fraser, followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Good morning, panel. I'd like to start off by asking a question to follow up questions from Maggie Chapman at the start around funding. The committee was in Perth on Monday, and we met two excellent social enterprise projects which are involved in helping young people with autism and with learning difficulties into the workplace. And it was very positive to see the outcomes from that. But an issue they raised with us was around certainty of funding and the difficulty, something, Alistair, you touched on earlier about the lack of certainty year to year. But even worse than that, we had an example of projects which were already some weeks into the current year and still hadn't had an award letter, and therefore were almost finding almost impossible to do any sort of sensible forward planning. We also see the SPICE briefing we have for the committee says that in the Scottish Government's budget for the current year, employability funding has been cut by 24% in real terms, a very substantial cut, and perhaps an expectation that local authorities will pick up the slack. So I'd be interested to get your perspective, maybe start with you, Alistair, on two issues. One, the overall quantum of funding for employability and what impact that cut's going to have, but also around this issue about future planning and certainty.
Yeah, it is a big issue. You're absolutely right, and it's a live issue right now. Last year, we were 3 months delayed in getting our funding allocated to us through a grant offer letter, and I don't know how long it'll be this year. The expectation would be in early April to allow us to plan for that year ahead. The 24% is a cut. Yeah, I think, yes, it is a cut. It's how it's divided, I suppose, in terms of what the different sectors that come into funding for child poverty, no one left behind. And it's how we use resources and best match that in to ensure we're getting the most we can for the funding and ensure it goes far and wide. And that's why we need our third sector partners to be active and be a part of that. And we need that to happen, I think. We can't do it all ourselves as a local authority. We need the LEP to be that vehicle that drives that and promotes the uptake opportunities to our third sector providers. If we know our budget, we can work with that. We would work with that. We don't know our budget, so it's very difficult to plan for the whole year. But there are, on your second point in terms of the third sector, and you know that they rely completely, not just third sector, all sector rely on staffing costs to be met. And, you know, that's your core delivery. Before you even look at individual projects, it's to ensure there's a continuity. We can't just stop a service on the 31st of March. We need to continue that because it's our clients we're working with, the relationships we've built up, the support mechanisms that are in place. So it's a real struggle just now. And it's quite a worry, to be honest with you, for a lot of people.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if Elizabeth, you want to come in on the same point?
Yes, certainly the uncertainty of the funding, the annual funding cycle is, in my opinion, our biggest challenge. I'm not saying we would get everything right if we got multi-annual funding, but we would be able to plan and there would be more scope to learn lessons and actually implement those lessons and listen to the voices of those with lived experience and genuinely be able to input to that into future delivery. So the future planning aspect is absolutely crucial. I mean, it is within employability in total, but especially when we're looking at working with people with learning disability, physical disability, neurodiversity. We lose staff expertise, and we have done within Inverclyde, not within the local authority, but within organisations who are expert in this type of delivery. Because, again, of the uncertainty of the funding, and that's very discouraging. You have to then, you know, go through a recruitment process and try and re-establish some level of expertise to go forward. So it all genuinely has a negative impact on the quality of provision for the client, and that's all that this is about. It's about what's best for the client. I believe, as I say, the process is there now. If we can just get the funding element to attach to that, to be on a sustainable footing. Currently, we are not aware of what our funding allocation is for this current year. That makes it extremely challenging for local authorities who maybe don't have any other source of funding within their own resource. If you're in a local authority that maybe has that, you've got a bit of leeway, but it's still not the way we would want to operate on a genuine quality provision that is best for client and that is best in terms of, we mentioned sustainability of the outputs. To get sustainability of the outputs, we need to have a certainty of the funding that we can provide that service to the employers who take on people with a disability. The employer needs to know that we're still going to be there and support them through that process.
Thanks very much. I mean, it seems to be extraordinary that we're one month into the financial year and you still don't know what your funding settlement is. I just can't imagine how impossible that is to plan ahead. Philip, you were nodding your way through that. If you want to add anything.
I think, as Liz has said, this is our key issue that we really want to raise and flag up as part of this process, is that, you know, if you look at the Fair Start example, they had a long lead-in time when that was commissioned to put Fair Start services in place, and then they had a long period of time in terms of certainty of delivery for Fair Start, and they've now got a two-year period to actually exit clients, to give them the proper kind of exit they need out of the service to be able to get the right support right the way through. As Liz was saying, you know, we can't just stop services on 31st of March. Someone's going to need services after that to be able to transition into their kind of destination. So I think we need that same kind of level playing field in terms of what we're trying to deliver. Most of our delivery as a LEP is in partnership with third sector. So if we need to commission services with third sector, we need the time to commission those services. We need certainty in terms of what that funding is to be able to commission those services. And we need that kind of lead-in time to be able to deliver it and also have that exit at the end of the service. So I think that is our biggest challenge in terms of that. In terms of Edinburgh's example, just now we're in the same situation as Perth, where we've not got our award letter there from Scottish Government yet to be able to give those award letters to the third sector. Majority of our deliveries with third sector, and we're doing not in trust with them at the moment. They've very kindly not given notice. Well, some of them will have had to give notice to staff in terms of delivery because they've not been able to have that certainty, but they're still delivering services for us. They could have quite rightly turned around and said, well, you're only funding us till 31st of March, we can turn around and stop the service. But thankfully they've continued that delivery, but we could have been in that position. So we need to resolve that situation because it's the biggest issue we face each year. And it's been year on year for the last 4 years. It's not improved. If anything, it's got worse.
Thank you. I don't know, David, do you want to add something?
It's kind of coming up because, I mean, we're working with these young people who have kind of neurodiverse or disability, and it does take a considerable amount of work to support them and get their their confidence up to take on these opportunities. And we are noticing that as young people are transitioning, that there maybe is a change of provision or available provision across local authorities. But it's not just a lack of provision, it's actually the negative effect it has on those customers. Actually makes it even harder for them to engage or come forward to engage in the provision. So just that it has a longer term impact than just the provision in supporting young people and adults to move forward.
Okay, great. Okay, thanks very much.
Before I bring Brian Whittle in, Elizabeth, can I just ask, I think at the start you said that you were providing wage incentives for employers or wage supplements. Is that then something that your local authority decided to do through the No One Left Behind money, or is that the flexibility that comes with the funding, or how are you delivering that?
Yeah, the employer recruitment incentive was available across the LEPs or the local authority delivery mechanism. And again, dependent on the level of funding, would dictate how much a local authority could actually put towards that specific aspect of delivery. Sadly, the kind of Fair Work First agenda is going to kind of alter that because we would only be able to use the funding to support an employer who meets all of the Fair Work First conditionality. And for a lot of smaller organisations, they don't. However, again, within a local authority who has other sources of funding, its own money, they still may be able to support those small and medium-sized enterprises by incentivising them to take someone with a disability with some financial support through the employer recruitment incentive, but only on the basis of there is longevity of that employment once that employer recruitment incentive has actually been maximised.
Okay, thank you. Brian, what would be followed by Evelyn Tweed?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. We've heard today, and we've heard in our previous evidence sessions that we've been speaking to the young people involved about so many of the great services that are available out there. Yet we do have a comparatively high level of unemployment among our disability communities. So I suppose really first question would be, are the employability services in Scotland managing to reach out to enough of our disability community to tackle this issue? I'll come to Elizabeth first, if that's okay.
I think there's a few things there. It's about reach, and we've spoke about using, being out in the community, using community link workers, using our health service, working in partnership with SDS to kind of co-locate and have youth hubs within their offices. All of that helps with the reach and for people maybe to be in a setting, nothing to do with employability, but while they're there, whether it's a health activity they're doing or a craft activity, they hear and they see and they know about the provision that's there. So we do all that, and that will improve the reach. But in terms of making employers come along on this journey, I still think we've got a lot to do there. So I think we need to seriously look at across the 32 local authorities, is there provision that can be put in place that would be specialist support to employers in terms of needs identification and a kind of training needs analysis type aspect to their workforce that would then allow us to maybe even free up some folk who are in employment to move further up the ladder within their employment, and that would free up entry-level jobs. There have been programmes like that over the years, but they are quite expensive. They are quite long-term as well before you're really going to reap the reward. But I do think we need to look at the long-term, and as we've mentioned, to do that, we need a more sustainable funding model.
I suppose if I can come to you, Dave, just to sort of expand that a little bit. I did a couple of sort of events in my own communities around, employers and bringing employers in to get them to understand what support is available to them to bring the disability workforce into employment. And I was surprised how little they knew at the outset of what's available to them. So are we missing a trick here?
I think there's we provide opportunities to. We're working with employers with apprenticeships. We'll explain the opportunities and what funding's there. But then also we'll direct them to the appropriate partners to kind of pick up. And DYW is doing a great job in trying to recognise employers and the opportunities that young people and then moving it on to adults as well. But we do our best to kind of to recognise, for employers to recognise what skills that people in neurodiverse and disabled can bring to the workforce. And there has been a slight increase, some evidence to show that during hybrid working, there's been that has increased slightly. But there's more definitely we need to do.
I don't know if Philip or Alistair, you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, in terms of an Edinburgh perspective, we've tried to put in place Edinburgh Guarantee, so there's that kind of recognised brand in terms of how people can access our services. Mm-hmm. So that's about making sure that anyone can get access to the support they need to get into training or employment. So that's how we've kind of tried to make sure that those that are maybe not usually engaged with services are aware of what we're trying to do. So that's quite a strong brand in Edinburgh. So hopefully that's helping us to engage with those that wouldn't usually engage with employability services. And I think there has also been that kind of national guarantee through Young Persons Guarantee, and that was really successful in engaging young people in that concerted effort when there was youth unemployment. And there was that kind of national branding and programme to actually engage those that wouldn't usually engage or not know about services. So I think there's an opportunity there to do something similar for those with a disability.
Yeah, I'm the same. We're working, start working quite closely with Business Gateway and the Borders as well, just to look at the opportunities that might come from that as well. New businesses come to the area as well as expanding, so along with DYW. And I think it's everybody's role to promote opportunities in a workplace. But if we're a dedicated resource, potentially that could make a significant impact.
If I could just change tack a little bit here. We heard some evidence last week for some young people in here around their journey, if you like, because you know this journey into to employment, and the number of steps there are before they get to employment, and a lot of them. And we heard that you know we asked them questions around you know their experiences at school, and a lot of them are saying their experiences at school were were poor or traumatic even. And then that interaction with DWP probably wasn't, well, they didn't have the appropriate skills at DWP to deal with the journey that they have to be on to get to employment. And actually they got to employment through a third sector organisation. So that there's are we joining up those dots enough? Are we catching or are we supporting these young people early enough? Because obviously you can't have all the skills at schools, you can't have all the skills at DWP. Are we catching them early enough to help them on that journey? David?
Yeah, we do. Within our service offer, we work very closely with our schools and our teachers, and we target, although our service offer at schools available to everybody, as I said earlier on, we target that offer working with the guidance teachers and the teachers to make sure that we're identifying the young people who maybe need that extra support, and we adapt our service offers to support that young person as they transfer school, whether they leave at fourth year, fifth year or sixth year, we'll support them. But we'll also make sure that support's in place to help them with their transition, be that into college or across to one of our LET partners to take on some provision. So the mechanism is there, and we have a good robust system around 16 plus data hub, and when we know young people kind of fall out. The other thing we've added to that recently that's reinforced that is we've got some HMRC data that's coming in, so now we can identify people in employment. So we are trying to improve all the time. And where there is gaps, we'll speak to our local employability partners. We'll update FE and HE partners around kind of what we're picking up across the economy, what employers are telling us nationally about the opportunities and stuff coming up. And we will try to promote the diversity that our young people and adults can support across Scotland, because I know we're focused a lot on young people this morning, but it's also about people who are maybe neurodiverse and disabled that are currently in employment. How do we support them to kind of to upskill and take those new opportunities that we're providing across Scotland? So and people can come into our service at any age and contact us, and that's where the partnership's strong, from CPPs all the way down with the local outcome improvement plans to the local action plans that are put in place with our LET partners. So we are trying and we keep improving, and as we improve, something else might come along that we need to adapt and move forward. And I think with this challenges on the public sector finances, as public sector organisations with our LET partners, we have kind of, it's brought us closer together and how we operate as a partnership kind of moving forward, to make sure that we are using our resources wisely to target those key areas across those local authority areas, and to seize the opportunities that may be coming through with employment. But that can be challenging at times with some of the lack of provision that might be that impact local authorities in different ways.
I'll bring you in, Philip. I mean, one of the things that really interests me is how we utilise the third sector in this area as well as a resource. And how easy that is, especially under stringent funding constraints, how we can utilise them as well.
In terms of the practical terms, in terms of how that's delivered on the ground, and each school's got 16 plus meetings, and the way that's delivered in Edinburgh is that we have round the table there SDS, we've got third sector partners, and we've specifically commissioned services with the third sector to actually offer that support for that transition when young people are leaving school. And something this year we're going to add to that is a specific service for those with additional support needs, subject to funding being available to do it. But that's something we're going to add to what our delivery is at the moment. So in terms of that kind of schools mechanisms, there's a really well kind of established, robust kind of tracking process, and that's then followed up as part of the participation measures as well as the destination. And something that's then going to change this year, we had Fair Start previously with DWP. There's now going to be single point of contacts through No One Left Behind. So through those single point of contacts, I would hope that would have a similar kind of process where we would be then looking at who, from DWP's perspective, on their books, if you like, and needs that support, and we can then look at how we can make sure they're getting access to the services that are available in that partnership. The majority of our services in Edinburgh are delivered with third sector. We do very little delivery from a kind of point of view as an authority. Obviously, there's significant resource there from DWP, Skills Development Scotland, and the other kind of partners. But in terms of third sector, that's a significant part of our delivery in terms of what we do.
I don't know if Alistair or Elizabeth want to add anything to that at all.
The only thing I would add to that, the board is we have a 14-plus meeting, similar to 16-plus, and it's all key partners around that table to discuss individuals to ensure that, you know, they're going to a positive destination and the support's there, the right support's there. So that's happening through all nine high schools. And it's the same partners around Alep, to be perfectly honest with you. So it's a collective approach to that. And ensuring we're getting the right opportunities at the right time. So,
last word to you, Elizabeth, if you've anything to add.
Yeah, I would just say the third sector are absolutely key to the delivery of No One Left Behind in totality, which includes the disability aspect. We couldn't deliver the quality of provision that we have across the local authorities without the third sector. Our challenge is often then is just what mechanism do we use to engage the third sector, and usually that is within a procured or a commissioned route, which is lengthy just by its nature. So again, I'm sorry to repeat, but the funding element really does have a bearing on that. But absolutely, certainly within Inverclyde, we use the national third sector and local third sector experts. And that provides the quality of provision that we're looking for.
Thank you. Good morning, panel, and thanks for your answers so far. Dave, you said in your opening statement that provision varies across local authorities, and you also mentioned partnership agreements. See those initial partnership agreements, how important are they in terms of the final delivery provision?
So our partnership agreements are key within our schools to define with, along with the schools, what our service offer is for that year and how we're going to deploy our resources to deliver those services across broad general education and senior phase, but also to identify maybe anything that we need to put in place to support transitions from school onto FEHE or apprenticeships. So they are critical. We do them every year, and there's review periods built in within those partnership agreements as well, where we work very closely with the school leadership team and the guidance teachers. So that's kind of delivered by both our practitioners in school, our careers advisors, and also our local leadership team to make sure that we have the appropriate agreements in place and mechanisms to make sure we're deploying our resources to give the appropriate support.
So if you felt that there were issues, you know, things not maybe they weren't quite on top of, you would have those conversations annually?
Yeah, definitely. We speak to them annually, and we also meet with directors of education or the heads of schools bi-monthly, quarterly, so we'd pick up any concerns. And our partnerships with schools across Scotland is very strong, and it's a two-way process. It's also how we can improve and how they can improve and how we combine those resources together to support our young people. So it's pretty robust, and that's been picked up when we've been inspected by Education Scotland, etc. as well.
And can I ask, I haven't actually looked at one of these partnership agreements, but are they generally the same across the piece?
Well, our service offers generally is the same across Scotland. How we deploy that and when we do that at different points of the year during the curriculum can alter at times from school to school. But Where there's areas of improvement, where the service that we're both providing could be fantastic, but we can always improve, that will vary from school to school across Scotland. But also the needs of those young people that we're supporting, they're all different. Every young person we support across the schools are all different in the communities they live in. So we do have nuances across Scotland, and we make sure that we are deploying our services and enhancing our service to make sure we're delivering for those young people and schools.
Okay. Does anyone else have any comments about partnership agreements?
Not particularly. I don't think, as far as we know, they kind of work well with schools, and I think that SDS have got a good relationship with schools from what we've seen in terms of delivering in Edinburgh, so nothing to add, really.
Okay, that's fine. Thanks for that, Dave. And what specific progress has been made in delivering on the recommendations of the 2022 review of supported employment? And then to anyone who would want to come in.
Yeah, I'll just come in there. I think certainly borders, I think a big part of it is ensuring there's a consistent approach in terms of standards, to ensure, for example, I mentioned earlier, the five-stage process of support employment for the specialist service. So we've put some staff through that training, through BASE, British Association for Support Employment. It's very similar to the PDA model. However, it's been very well received. So that consistent approach across our staff and that awareness, and even experienced staff we've put through, so there's that theory behind the practice to ensure that we're getting the most out of that. And we'll continue to look at how we can upskill our staff to ensure that support's there, because I truly believe that standard has to be in place to ensure that everyone's getting a quality service. And another report, you know, highlights that and certainly part of it as well. So.
Yeah, I think in terms of Edinburgh, we've obviously got our support employment service, which is now a tried and tested kind of model of delivery, and I think it's working really well for us. In terms of what we're delivering in Edinburgh, we've also added to that Project Search, in terms of specifically a service for young people. So I think we do have good models there that are supporting that kind of reducing that gap. And I think there's also good work being done with employers as well in terms of our partners and working with that care employer engagement piece. And I think there's a lot of training been happening, a lot of awareness raising been happening with employers. So that kind of message is getting out there more than it maybe has been in the past. So I think, I'd say there's still a long way to go with that, but I think there has been inroads made.
Elizabeth, do you want to come in?
Yes, certainly there is progress in terms of us working towards decreasing the disability employment gap. And Scottish Government are within this year's allocation of No One Left Behind, potentially going to have within the offer grant maybe some specifics about what that will entail for this year. We'll wait to see what that is. But ahead of that, we've all had to kind of push on and either procure or deliver directly. So within Inverclyde, we do have a supported employment following the True Fidelity model, which Enable provide for us. We have a local third sector organisation providing a health barriers to employment contract, which is slightly different, but again will make inroads into us having a positive impact on the disability employment gap. And we also within our Enable contract have an employed engagement aspect, which is about raising awareness for the local employers in terms of recruitment practices, the positivity of having a more diverse workforce. So that sits alongside that. So yes, work is progressing, but again, for some, the work is probably halted until we get some funding certainty.
Kevin Stewart, that you wish to.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning again to you all. I'm very interested in the voices of lived experience, and we were very lucky last week to have a group of folk who told it like it was, really, and that's beneficial to all. And I think it's key for us all to listen to people about their experiences in order to improve. Alistair, you mentioned Project Search earlier. Philip, you've just mentioned it. One of the positives from last week's discussion was a high opinion of Project Search. From my own constituency in Aberdeen, Project Search there, run by the University of Aberdeen, backed by the likes of Values Into Action Scotland, have got some immense outcomes. With folk going into work and staying in work in the main. Why don't we learn from the experiences of Project Search and create more of those type of schemes throughout the country? Who wants to take that on first?
I'm happy to come in terms of... I think we need to be careful in terms of balance, in terms of how we kind of manage the structure of our delivery. I think... kind of short-term initiatives can have really kind of positive impacts, but I think we need to look at longevity in terms of services that we deliver. So I would kind of err on caution in terms of short-term projects that might have short-term results. I think we want to look at long-term kind of structural side of things. And I think one of the challenges is that a lot of the delivery that we do, we've got that structure in place, so no one left behind now, but we hide the wiring with that. So the person on the ground that's getting a service doesn't necessarily realise it's a no one left behind service, and that's quite right. They know that kind of branded service on the ground that's giving them support, because that's who their kind of touch point is in terms of who they're supported by. So there'll be a lot of people that will be getting support from services but not actually realise where the funding's coming from and what that kind of route is in terms of that support. So I think we do have that opportunity with the No One Left Behind to make sure that we've got that structure in place to have those kind of initiatives and projects and programmes in place, and we've got that opportunity to do that over a longer term period of time.
I'm interested that you said short term there, because Project Search in Aberdeen doesn't seem short term to me. Obviously, the job opportunity within the university is short term. Folk change roles, but the key thing is that a large majority of folk go into employment and retain employment. Now, that's not short term to me.
Yeah, I suppose the challenge with that delivery model is we're talking about the funding piece for that is for the delivery of the Project Search. It's about making sure those structures round about it are there for that followed-on supported employment model, which is what we try to deliver in terms of our services. So that supported employment makes sure it's not just when they get to employment, it's that all that full length of that kind of delivery. So it's about making sure that anything we do put in place has got that length of time to do justice in terms of that delivery, if that makes sense.
OK. Does anyone else want to come in on that?
Yeah, I'll just come in. Please, quickly. Alex, yeah. Project Search, you're right, it's a great model. The fidelity of the model is, you know, it was for people with disabilities. We've opened up additional support needs to ensure we can reach the people that are going to, you know, get the benefit of it. But there's something that could be done similar, potentially, for different client groups, absolutely. It is quite an expensive model, but you're right, the outcomes are pretty good with it. And I think the key is to have that wraparound support after that project ends. So, you know, there's ongoing support there. But we're not undoing all the good work. They want to ensure that there's a key worker linked to the people. So there's a continuity in that person, that point of contact, because it could be quite easy just, you know, for something to happen. They lose their job and, you know, it's nobody really picked up. So we need to ensure that wraparound support is there, ongoing.
Grand, and I agree with that, and that seems to happen in terms of the Aberdeen scenario anyway. There was a great video produced of folks who had been through Project Search who gave their opinions about it, and you know, it was absolutely fantastic to hear their experiences. I want to move on around about diversity, because, you know, we are living in a world now with a huge amount of diverse jobs, and what we need is a diverse workforce, but we have to have employers who have a level of understanding of people, but also flexibility. How can we ensure that employers become more flexible when it comes to employing neurodiverse people? What do you think could push them further?
Could I ask the panellists to be brief in any replies? I am keen to bring another member in, and we are getting a bit short of time.
I think there is stuff that we are doing as an organisation, and I think just to be brief, I will provide that to the committee in a paper, because we have teams that are going out for modern apprenticeships, we're working with employers, we're trying to highlight the opportunities with kind of being flexible workforce and the other opportunities and skills that and the growing skills that Scotland needs to kind of grow our economy and those opportunities. So I'll provide a paper to the committee.
Examples of employers would be absolutely immense if you could do
I'll do my best.
Thank you. Anyone else want to come in that?
In terms of the work that we're doing in Edinburgh, I think it is about that relationship building, that employer engagement, and I think we just need to keep on at that and make sure that's a continual piece of work to actually work with employers and keep raising that awareness, keep offering that training, keep that messages out there in terms of the benefits, in terms of supporting those that are
I'll leave it at that and hopefully get that paper from Mr.
Thank McCall. You. We will hear from employer representatives in the next few weeks. Bob Dorras.
Well, thank you, Convener. I'm over pressed for time, so I'll try and be brief. Hopefully two brief questions. The first, like, maybe to Elizabeth Baird, because back to earlier comments Elizabeth made about supporting employers to be more confident in taking on people living with disabilities. That can, of course, be when vacancies arise, thinking about a person with disabilities could take on that position, but it could also be getting into a large employer and saying, let's look at your setup as an employer. Where could there be positions that would be suitable for someone with disabilities? Does that second thing happen? I could see a little bit more about that.
I think it needs to happen more, and I think that would make a real inroad. So while we're all doing employability and getting people ready, supporting confidence, providing vocational skills, if we don't have employers there to then take individuals in, and I do genuinely think that it's a real practical level that employers are needing. It's, they are busy doing their doings. They're, you know, business people, and they might want to support disability employment gap, but they genuinely need it at a real practical level. So they need that support coming into their workforce and providing them with a kind of short, sharp intervention to say, I've looked at the roles you have available and I believe these roles we could adapt, we could put in some flexibility, whether it be instead of one full-time person, it's two part-time roles, and that role itself within X amount of weeks, we could get someone with a learning disability to be at the standard that the employer would be comfortable with and the employee would be comfortable in fulfilling that role in a proper fair work scenario.
Only because of time constraints, I won't ask other witnesses whether that happens more. But if that does happen more often, I think the committee would be quite keen to hear it, because obviously if you wait till employers have vacancies and then they go to yourselves and say, how can a disabled person fit that role? Then they've already created a job that might not be suitable for someone with additional barriers to, sort of the clumsy expression, mainstream employment. So I might just pursue my final question with Elizabeth Baird, and that is, employers, of course, may be close to thinking we have got a business model to employ maybe another 1.5 employees, irrespective of whether that person has disabilities or not. But it's a fine line, tipping points when going to recruitment and just not expanding employees. And I think Ms. Baird talked about wage subsidies earlier on as well. Could you just give a little bit of clarity where those wage subsidies come from and what role the DWP has in that? Now, a lot of people seeking employment would be on ESA. I know they can keep some of their ESA under 16 hours a week in employment, but there must surely be a business model there where if we get people into long-term, well-paid jobs and off of ESA, the taxpayer's a winner, the DWP's a winner, more importantly, the person with disabilities is a winner. Community Jobs Scotland, for example, was very good at doing that kind of thing. So anything about where wage subsidies do play a part and where opportunities are to do more of that?
Yeah, again, across the local authorities, we had the Employer Recruitment Incentive, but also certainly within Inverclyde, we have Wage Subsidy Programme, which is funded by the council's own resource, but also No One Left Behind funding, and that would be providing up to £10,000 for a local employer to hire a local person, whether that be into, we had an apprentice wage subsidy programme, but we also had where we couldn't match the role to a specific formal apprenticeship, we could have that as a traineeship, and we had graduate wage subsidy programmes. So again, incentivising the employer to take from the local workforce and or to take specific clients with specific barriers into local employment.
And was there a partnership? I'm not trying to get an issue that's not there, I'm trying to think about an opportunity. Was there a proactive partnership to DWP, or is that something that would be beneficial in the future?
Yes, no, we worked in partnership with DWP, especially when we were looking at moving people with a disability and who were on maybe specific benefits. And it's an ongoing piece of work that I'm actually meeting with colleagues next week just to look about how we define that and how do we maximise that, looking at maybe economically inactive residents and those who have stated they have a willingness to work. So we are trying to kind of come together to see how we can put these two strands together and make it more attractive for the employer.
Well, so we'd love to convene. I know you're pressed for time. I won't ask any more questions, but thank you very much.
Thank you. That now concludes the first part of the evidence session. Dave McCallum has generously offered to send us more materials. If anybody else has more material that they felt they couldn't share with us this morning, we'd be happy to receive it. I thank you all for your contributions, and we briefly suspend the meeting while we change our witnesses. May I welcome David Cameron, Chief Executive Officer, Scottish Union of Supported Employment, Oksana McGregor-Gunn, Assistant Director of Operations with Scottish Action for Mental Health, and Ashley Ryan, Director of Enable Works Enable. Thank you all for coming in this morning. I'm going to start with a question that relates to our previous panel, if we come to Ashley first. So we've had a change from the delivery model from Fair Start Scotland to No One Left Behind. And No One Left Behind has then led to the creation of the LEPs, the Local Employment Partnerships, and we had witnesses from there this morning. So I'm just interested in your view on how the Local Employment Partnerships are working, what you think the impact of them are, if they've been a positive move.
We have been engaging with the LEPs for a number of years now, and I think that at times it can be quite inconsistent about how regular they meet post-COVID, how transparent that process is at times can be quite inconsistent. But I think in the last year or so we've seen real strides forward where LEPs are looking to engage the third sector a bit more closely to understand the needs on the ground. So we've seen some real strides forward, but I would say that they still remain a little inconsistent in terms of how transparent that is, who's on the LEPs, how you can become part and engage with those LEPs a bit more closely, and the kind of purpose of what they're doing.
Yeah, that's kind of reflected in the IPPR report that was recently published. Maybe come to Oksana, the same question about how you feel the delivery model with the No One Left Behind and the LEPs is working.
Very, very similar view. Inconsistent, various from one local authority to another. In some, it's working very well indeed. In some, it doesn't really work for us. I'm only talking about our experience. So I would say inconsistent.
And when it's inconsistent, what is it about the ones that aren't working? Is it, I think Ashley mentioned, lack of transparency or difficulty with engaging. Is that the experience that you have as well?
Yeah, communication might be inconsistent again. Sometimes it's quite difficult to identify who is actually on the LEP, though this is published, but engagement with LEPs can be problematic sometimes.
Mm-hmm. And is that, David, is that similar to your view of how they're operating?
Certainly. Curiously enough, our conference is in a couple of weeks' time and our panel discussion is based on how is No One Left Behind working for disabled people, because we're curious, obviously, to get feedback from our membership and the wider sector. It's certainly a mixed bag, I think, is what we're hearing so far. It's early. I think it's fair to say it's early, but not hearing a huge amount coming through that it's making any kind of radical difference and improvement for disabled people, which obviously is what we want to see.
Left Behind, so we saw a devolution of employment policy to local authorities and to local partnerships to, I suppose, deliver more kind of policies that were bespoke to the local area and that were closer to the local area. But do you feel it's the government's policy to close the employment gap? Is there enough done from a government policy level? And if we, I think already, I mean, Evelyn might come back to this, but the question around the review that was done, the 2022 review of supported employment and the recommendations that came from that, most of them are kind of aimed towards Scottish Government or that level of government. And the Fair Work Convention did a recent report into Scotland's progress as a Fair Work Nation, where we come on a list of 8, we come 6th in terms of our progress on closing the disability employment gap. Denmark is way at the top, but Denmark at a national level has invested a lot into employment services, whether that's subsidies for firms or it's various other, you know, government policies, wage subsidies, positive discrimination, preferred access to employment for disabled applicants. So while the No One Left Behind money is funding the local employment partnerships, it's the government's commitment to close the employability gap. Do you feel there's more the government could be doing? We do recognise we're in difficult financial times, but there's more that you think they could be doing to come to David first.
We wait to see what happens with the supported employment review. It was published in late 2022. We brought together our members with quite a bit of excitement in 2023. It doesn't happen often in our sector, but we're really quite excited about something happening. There were elements within the supported employment review that we thought were excellent. It certainly spoke to things like investment in the sector and, you know, things happening. This is a big issue for us. Staff development, skills development within the sector. We had put forward a proposal for a supported employment guarantee, which was thinking about the kind of the geographical spread of supported employment and what disabled people might be entitled to or should be entitled to expect in all parts of Scotland. It spoke about quality. So there was many elements within it that we were very, very excited about. I had some conversations with senior civil servants in 2023, talking about some preliminary ideas for implementation. There has literally been nothing since. So again, this is a promotional exercise, I do apologise. At our conference, we have invited Scottish Government civil servants to come along and give an update on the support employment review, because I actually kind of felt as if we can't have another conference where we don't mention it, because it feels as if we forgot about it, it disappeared. So we're really keen to see the support employment review recommendations taken forward. We do understand, obviously, the financial constraints. I suppose there must now be a question of where the responsibility for that sits. Is it government? Is it local authorities who now have so much responsibility? But we look forward to seeing something resolved and some progress on that pretty quickly.
Good, thank you. And Ashley and Ogdana, because the earlier panel, I think it was Philip, talked about, you know, we had a young person's guarantee, Edinburgh's introduced an Edinburgh guarantee. One of the recommendations was the guarantee. Do you think there needs to be, would you look for clarity around the 2022 review? And I'll come to Ashley first.
Yeah, so Edinburgh is a prime example of somewhere that's heavily invested in supported employment. So we deliver a partnership of four organisations that deliver full fidelity supported employment. We've been funded for 7 years, funded for another 6 years. That is the kind of absolute outlier. That doesn't usually happen. And we've found the greatest success in a local authority that have invested heavily, you know, in that area. And I guess from our point of view, the inconsistencies come from local authorities' understanding of what supported employment actually is in some cases, or whether we've had a lot of conversations about could it be supported employment light, which is not supported employment, it's employability support. So from our point of view, local authorities that heavily invest in it and understand the need for that sort of programme see the greatest success.
So some of the differences between local authorities is to do with their understanding and definitions or lack of clarity of what it is they're trying to deliver?
I think in some cases it's resource. So some of the smaller local authorities don't potentially have the resource that the larger local authorities have to be able to implement a large-scale supported employment provision. And certainly from what David said about the supported employment review, we've seen elements of that come out through the local authorities, but not a consistent approach to that. And probably that's where we'd like to see Scottish Government really taking a stand in terms of we're not seeing that kind of need for qualified staff or the quality framework. You know, I think in terms of services like IPS, there's been a kind of greater focus on fidelity reviews and quality reviews of IPS services, and that kite mark to say that you are actually delivering a really exceptional service. That doesn't happen in supported employment, and it absolutely should happen, because that kite mark in IPS really means that you're following that model and has the greatest success. Mm-hmm. And I'd love to see something like that more consistently delivered across Scotland.
Kevin Stewart in for a supplementary before I come to Colin Smith.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks for that answer, Ashley. And I recognise what you're saying about smaller local authorities maybe not having the resource. Is there any good examples of local authorities cooperating with one another to make sure that the right resource is there? I know from my home patch that there are some collaborations between Aberdeen City and Aberdeenshire, for example. Is there good practice out there in terms of collaboration between local authorities on this front?
Yeah, so we've seen some really good practice come out from Forth Valley as well, local authorities that tend to work really closely together. They have commissioned us to deliver supported employment across the Forth Valley region. So what that does is allows us to deliver the principles of No One Left Behind, understanding the nuances between Clacks and Falkirk and Stirling, but also allowing us to deliver a real team around quality, qualified staff. So that's a good example of where local authorities have came together and really put out that resource together.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Colin Smith, followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good still morning. Good morning to the panel. Can I just ask, a specific question around the delivery of services. There was an IPPR report that recently noted a perceived conflict of interest for local authorities who have obviously got responsibility for commissioning and delivering employability services. That report suggested that local authorities may be incentivised to prioritise in-house services over third sector services. Do you think that's a fair comment?
You can try it.
One third of our members are local authorities, so we obviously have to be quite balanced in how we approach it. Yes, that is the case. Local authorities deliver plenty of high quality services, so there's not an issue about them not delivering. I used to work in the voluntary the service delivery frontline for about 20 years, and I think that we'd always had the perception of being held to higher standard. I think the in-house services would have been held expecting more return for the investment, more job outcomes. I suppose the question would be that if you choose to do it in-house and it's not successful, what do you do next? Is it likely that a local authority will effectively close down that service or hand it out to the voluntary sector? Would that have issues in terms of their staffing and things like that? Is that likely to happen, I think, is the question. But it's not to say there's not plenty of good local authority services, but yes, a very big proportion of the cake is generally kept in-house.
Is that a fair reflection?
I mean, we've had some success in, like, Dundee, for example. We are actually commissioned to deliver it as a partnership of eight providers, of which the local authority is one. So actually, we, as an interest in change and dynamic, we manage the performance of our local authority delivery. And actually, we've seen great success because it's a more cohesive offer. It's a really clear offer. People come in to one door. They're not coming into Dundee Council and then coming into All in Dundee. So there has been some examples where it's worked really well. But certainly in some areas, you will find that most of the money is kept in-house for those sorts of services.
Is that just because of a time budgets for local authorities are so under pressure, then it's a natural thing for them to do to maintain the services within that local council?
Well, it's natural. We would say it's quite a natural way of carrying out business, if you wish. In better times, there is more engagement with the third sector. And it's always very successful. My fellow panelists already kind of highlighted the fact that we are in the third sector, it is more transparent what the outcomes are delivered in value for money. However, it's usually a financial decision as well as kind of engagement, I suppose, decision.
There can be an issue about control as well, yeah. And I understand that. We did an interesting piece of work for a small local authority recently, and they asked us to talk to and look at the different organisations in their area that were working with young people, young disabled people looking for work in some form or other. It could be volunteering, it could be, you know, further education, it could be different community activities or actual supported employment. And in this small local authority area, we spoke to 24 different organisations. And one of the reasons they asked us to do the exercise in the first place, because there was a real sense of no coordination. People couldn't find the right thing for themselves, or they would move between things, and it wasn't quite clear why that would be the case, because it wasn't a pathway towards employment. It was, what's the next thing? That didn't work for me, what's the next thing? There wasn't any real sense of planning, and certainly for the person themselves, no sense of ownership of their journey towards employment. So it's understandable in some ways that local authorities might feel as if we keep this here, we can control it and we can better manage people through the process as it was. But there's other ways of doing that effectively. You know, you can have consortia, you can have different relationships and partnerships that can be managed very effectively if you get the communication right and the record keeping right and all that kind of thing.
Okay, that's helpful. Can we move on to a different subject? A question I asked employability partnerships is, I mean, every week I speak to a business, and one of the biggest issues at the moment is challenges over recruitment. They can't fill vacancies, yet we have this significant disability employment gap. The two things are just completely disconnected. So what do we have to do? Or why do you think that at the moment so many employers don't get the business case for closing that employment gap? That there's this huge potential workforce out there at a time where businesses are struggling to fill vacancies. Why don't they get those opportunities? What's the barriers for them understanding it?
Well, I can say from the mental health perspective, I think the gap can be closed significantly with the right approach. And my colleague Ashley already mentioned individual placement and support model, which is a supported employment model specifically designed to support people with severe and enduring mental health issues to seek and get employment and sustain employment as well. But the beauty of the whole supported employment model is to support employers as well, mm-hmm. educate, support, engage with workforce they didn't even know existed out there. They can be very successful because people are very appreciative of all the support. I mean, people with disabilities, they really become absolutely excellent workforce. But for that, we need to work very closely with employers because there is still some ignorance and misunderstanding and not actually quite be sure how to engage with workforce which is diverse and maybe not quite familiar to them. So I would say this gap can be really significantly closed through really very tailored work with employers.
Can I speak to the? Uh-huh. Can I answer that as well? Sure. We recently led a partnership, a public social partnership, round about the disability employment gap, of which many 40 different organisations were members of the partnership, and it was focused on assisting employers to be better at attracting, recruiting and retaining disabled people. It's delivered over the past 4 years, it's just finished, and we've just handed over everything that the partnership developed to the government. And it was an absolutely fascinating piece of work because it's all focused on employers, and it gave us real insight into things like they have discriminatory practices, but they don't know they've got discriminatory practices because they don't test them. So, for example, there's online recruitment platforms. Everybody's gone online, and they don't work for disabled people, but nobody checks. So they also don't gather any data, gather some data, which will be a basic equality monitoring form, perhaps, if people are applying for a job. But they don't really know who they employ. They don't know the proportion of people who apply for jobs that are disabled or the proportion of people who get interviewed for jobs who are disabled. So you can't tell, you know, for example, you might have 10% applicants from disabled people. Well, if only 5% are getting through to interview, what's that telling you? If only 2% are getting a job, what's that telling you? They don't have this data. They don't know very much about the people they employ. They don't do nearly enough about disclosure. So there's more disabled people in employment than we know about or the employers know about. But that means that those people are not getting the support they need in employment. So they're more likely to leave employment. I did a piece of work a number of years ago on behalf of the Scottish Government, actually, and it was looking at the number of people who leave employment every year. And back then, 400,000 a year in the UK, it must be much higher now. So if you're talking about maybe 40,000 people a year leave employment in Scotland due to a disability or a health problem, if you were to able to reduce that significantly, if you could get 10,000 of those people staying in the job, you would make a big impact in the disability employment gap without putting a single extra person into work if you just stop people leaving work. Mm-hmm. So we need to be, employers don't know how to do that. They don't know enough about how to do the reasonable adjustments, the flexibility, the support that's out there. There's so many agencies that could help them with that. Although one of the challenges in that is that there's not really resource for that. Mm-hmm. There's resource for putting people into jobs, but there's not nearly enough resource for keeping people in jobs.
That's interesting.
So if you actually did more to do proper in-work support, or when people, you know, quite often for a person, they have a small problem, and it, because nobody addresses it, it kind of snowballs and becomes a big problem. It could be a health issue, it could be housing, it could be transport, it could be finances. If you don't deal with it, it becomes a big problem, and then before you know it, the person's out of a job, and they didn't need to be. So part of the support employment model, obviously, very key, is in-work support, and we would like to see a lot more attention and focus in that part.
That's interesting. Ashley, do you want to add to
that? Yeah, and we work with about 2,000 employers each year, and certainly our experience shows us that disability tends to be the thing that employers will tackle last. So we've focused on gender, we've focused on ethnically diverse employees, but disability tends to be the thing that comes last. And our work with employers is heavily focused on a policy around disability is not enough. It needs to be a living, breathing policy that actually is part of your everyday work. And there are some really easy adjustments that employers can make to help attract a more diverse workforce. So what we've tried to do is talk business language, talk about you are more productive, you have better problem solving in your business, you will actually make greater profits if you have a more diverse workforce. And that has to include people who are disabled as well. But employers need training. So some of the basic things we see is a timed application form. Something silly like a timed application form stops people who take longer to fill an application form in. We've saw people who are going to work in a large shop doing the stock in the back, and there was a maths test that most of my staff struggled to pass. So we were trying to work in, this is an entry level maths test that was completely irrelevant to the job. So what we're trying to get employers to focus on is take away things that you do not need. Do you need some of these criteria? Is that stopping people? Be much more direct about your diversity policies. Actually talk about it. You know, talk about what adjustments you can make. People don't know what adjustments they can have, what they can ask for. Be very blatant about what you can offer. We're working with some really big organisations like Diageo. We're putting in supported internships into their business because in one of their distilleries, they had something like 70 vacancies. And really well-paid jobs, really great careers for people, but they couldn't attract young disabled people into their business or young people at all. And some really small changes, they're starting to see some really big wins. But it's about how, because it's not enough to train our clients to be ready to go into work if they then can't progress in their careers, and trying to work with employers to say that actually most people in their life, not everyone is born disabled. They might develop a disability or health condition while they're at work. So it is your duty to also, similar to what David said, keep people in their job, people that are already in your business. How do you disclose a disability? How do you talk about it? And not just make it a network that meets once a quarter and they talk about it with other disabled people. It needs to be a very top-down approach for employers.
Is there sufficient awareness amongst businesses, and is there sufficient support when it comes to the various funding models and supported employment and various things? Is there sufficient support around just raising awareness amongst businesses? Is that a gap? Because it's interesting, because last week we met with Watch Young People from The Usual Place in Dumfries. They provide, in addition to the support for the young people, they provide a general autism awareness course, if you like, for businesses. But they seem to slip through every single funding model that goes, because they're not one thing or the other, because they're not specifically about an individual person. They're about just generally trying to support businesses to understand autism, but they struggle for funding. I mean, is that a gap in terms of getting that message across to businesses of these opportunities? Or does it just go back to, well, actually it's about a specific case of supporting the person in the workplace?
I mean, I think people focus heavily on the disability confidence scheme. You know, you've all these employers that call themselves disability confident leaders, and actually there's no quality benchmark behind that either. About, you can literally say we do this and they go great. They don't actually evidence whether that is being done. So I think sometimes that can make an employer look much more disability confident, and actually the reality is much less. But businesses need to recognise the economic benefit of having disabled people in their business as well. And yes, certainly for us, you could fund us and we would be able to deliver training. We've got something like 16 courses we can deliver to employers on a variety of things. But actually as well, businesses have to have greater understanding of the huge economic benefits that they can have by having a really diverse workforce, and them investing in that in the same way that they've invested in some of the other areas around diversity.
So why is the very opening point you made, Ashley, was that we've done gender, we've done ethnicity, why is disability way down the bottom of the priority for businesses?
I don't think it's ever came up as a big national campaign in the same way that gender does. You know, people report on their gender pay gap, even though the bot on Twitter hunts them down and tells them if that's reality. We don't put enough focus as a nation on, because even the disability employment gap, we don't talk about the disability pay gap. Disabled people earn 83 pence on average where a non-disabled person makes. They work the last 53 days of the year for free. That's not acceptable. So in a world where we want a fair work and we want everyone to have a world kind of leading working life, we need to focus on some of these things as well, because it's not enough to get someone a job. We want someone to have a career they can thrive.
Thank you.
Colin Beattie to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to pick up on one or two points I raised with the previous panel. We had the opportunity last week to talk to some of the youngsters that were had been through the system, so to speak, of employment. And they weren't very complimentary about the path that they had to follow. And bear in mind, this is only the people I spoke to myself. Job centres, for example, they had a very negative impact on them going to job centres because the job centres did not understand them, did not understand where they were coming from, and they couldn't cater for their needs, and they were sort of just parked aside and that was it. Is that the sort of experience that that you're aware of? Do you know if there's any data collection on this to see how many people actually experience this sort of negative situation? David, maybe I can ask you.
I don't think there's data. You will find it's quite a typical story for most young disabled people that they will go around the houses a bit before they land somewhere that works for them, because there is a real lack of good quality information for people and for their families to make informed judgments. It will also be the case, as we're talking about the provision of services in local areas, that, for example, supported employment, a local authority area might have one supported employment service that doesn't support that many people. So hopefully it's a great one, and hopefully it's, you know, everybody goes through it really successfully. But if it's not, disabled people don't often get much choice. You know, which is, I was talking previously about, there's lots and lots of services that can help people, but if you're focused on, I want to get a job, you don't often get a huge amount of choice in an area. And if it doesn't work for you, are you empowered to talk about that as people come back and asking you your experience? Are they then using that to improve the quality of the offer? Not nearly enough of that happens, and that's why Ashley was talking about, you know, quality standards and things like that are really, really important, because a quality standard would be 360 degrees and it would be talking very much about the user experience as much as anything else. So I think it is the case that we need much, much better quality information for people. But not online perhaps, but also face-to-face, you know, one-to-one stuff that people can go and investigate things, try things out, perhaps talk to other people that have been through a similar process, what's been working for you. We don't do nearly enough of that, and I would say it probably works particularly badly for young disabled people.
I'll turn to Oksana, but maybe I'll ask for a slightly different facet also in this question, because do we have any impression, since there's no data, of how good job centres are at actually catering for the needs of disabled people? Do they have the skills to do it? Based on what I've heard, it doesn't sound as confidence-giving as you might wish.
I would say, do they have the time to do it and the skills as well? So our experience is that young people we are supporting in our services have various feedback relating to their engagement with Job Center Plus. Most of it is not positive, I have to say. When they come to us for our support, we make sure that we engage them with Job Center Plus in the right way. So I would say they need support to engage back, because at the end of the day, Job Center Plus is absolutely crucial in this journey. However, in terms of support we provide, we feel that young people is a special group. Can I just pass on to Ashley at this point? Sorry, yeah. Ashley.
I think in terms of our experience for young people, we do not have enough aspirations for disabled young people. We are still seeing about 20% of young people with a learning disability leave school with zero qualifications above level 2. We need to start much earlier. 70%, roughly 72% of our clients are 16 to 29. And if we were delivering enough aspirations for those young people, they shouldn't really need our services as an adult. we need to work much, much earlier, because actually the key to halving the disability employment gap is for young disabled people to see employment as a viable option for them when they leave school. We deliver transitions programmes in school. We find that there are not only issues with Job Centre Plus, but there are issues with careers at times, where the careers advice is not tailored enough, or it feels like young people are being pushed into supported college courses. I don't think work's been explored enough as a viable option. We're still seeing young disabled people not getting a work placement in school unless their mum or dad can support them to do that. That's probably not that acceptable. And actually, we need to aspire much more for young people, so that by the time they come to us and they've left school, work is a real aspiration for them. They want to work, they have a drive to work, because otherwise they're going to become adults who are relying on welfare and are stuck in that hamster wheel of being on welfare or universal credit. And our engagement with Job Centre, most of our clients do not. So we engage with about 7,000 clients each year. Most of them don't come from the Job Centre. So we don't get huge numbers of people who engage particularly well with the Job Centre, because the Job Centre becomes a place where they can be sanctioned. They can lose their benefits, and we all know that sanctions do not support people to go into higher paid jobs. They actually support people into worse positions, lower paid jobs, less better positions. So the experience of our young people is not particularly positive with Job Centre, but equally is not particularly positive before that, because we don't have high enough aspirations for them.
Given that you seem to be validating the position of the young people we spoke to, which was quite negative about both the, what they were given in schools and what they were given at job centres, what feedback's being given on this? I mean, do job centres know that they're not doing a great job? Do schools know they're not doing a great job? Who's giving the feedback? David, perhaps.
I think this is not a new issue. You know, I used to work for Enable Scotland many years ago, and we had our first skills transition programme 16 years ago. And it was quite groundbreaking at the time to actually go into schools and what we were talking about at that point. I think it was from 14 years up. But obviously, young disabled people don't necessarily come through school with the expectation they will work. It's changing, it's getting better, but people don't talk to them in such a way as to what will you do when you grow up? What job will you have? Unfortunately, people talk to young disabled people quite differently sometimes, unfortunately. There is a great deal, you know, to do in that area, and yes, it would be a really valuable piece of research to actually carry out for young people who have come through, particularly the educational experience. How did it work for you? What did transition look like for you? What were the options that were put on the table for you? How long did it take you to get to where you wanted to be? I remember talking to one local authority and two senior figures in education, and one of them said, but we have got such a high proportion of young people going into a positive destination. And the person sitting next to them said, yeah, but what are they doing 6 months later? And that's a very interesting question. And that's the kind of thing that you need to pick up. How does it work in reality for people beyond some headline figures?
But if the system's not working, who's giving that feedback to the job centres and to the schools to say it's not working? Oksana?
I just want to say that we are not quite sure how the feedback loop is working in this respect. All I can say is that we provide a lot of support for people with severe injury and mental health issues, and they're adults. It's all started a lot younger, and talking about injury at more than 10 years, people we are supporting as adults have been experiencing that since very young age. It all starts very early. Lack of aspiration, maybe life skills, mental health issues, it all goes on and on and on without being addressed. And going back to Job Centre Plus, I think the part of it is, I think statistically, people have about 6 minutes per person at the appointment, and then all filled with completing the admin tasks. So talking to a young person or any person is only 6 minutes, if I remember it correctly. I doubt that you can actually address any issues. That's why young people you met with felt so disappointed at the whole kind of treatment, I suppose. When they come to us, there is a time and special skills, and we know how to work with people, with young people, to give them this confidence so they can actually have aspiration, and develop their skills to go into the workplace and have this confidence, voice their concerns to the employers. We work with employers, and the sooner we start this journey, obviously the better. We really need to start with young people so they wouldn't become service users, if you wish, of adult services, be it mental health learning difficulties, neurodivergent services. So I think this what is very, very important.
Ashley?
We did some research with teachers around their concerns for young disabled people, and they felt they didn't have the right training, or, you know, it's still an optional element of training for teachers. The number of young people identifying as having an additional support need has grown quite exponentially in the last few years. And where we're seeing the greatest success, because this is not about a school not doing a good job or DWP, this is about the circumstances. So in a school, employment's not necessarily their focus. Our focus is around educational attainment, around curriculum for excellence. So where we find great success is where you can bring in qualified staff to support with that. So our schools programme focuses on employability alongside the school, and where a school and an ABLE can work closest together, we see the greatest success, because then it balances educational attainment with what comes next, because it's very difficult to do all. And I think that we have to be mindful of that. This is not about saying that schools aren't doing it well. Similar to what Oksana said, DWP have a number of programmes that they can send people into, and giving them the time to deliver a quality service. You know, I haven't worked in a job centre, but I can imagine it can be quite challenging. Mm-hmm.
Sorry, some progress. Kevin Stewart, do you want a supplementary?
Just a very brief supplementary, convener. We've heard your answers to Mr. Beattie around about some of the bureaucracies maybe not doing things as they should be and not taking the time to listen. And you've talked a great deal, all of you just now, about aspiration. How do we help young disabled folk, neurodiverse folk, who want to establish their own businesses? Because again, we heard about that last week. What is out there to help young folk with an aspiration, a talent, to establish their own businesses? Is there anything?
For many years, I think there should be, but it's nothing unique, is it? Because if you're talking about the different local services that help anybody to establish a business, they should be able to put in adjustments and the supports for disabled people that want to do likewise. And it does, I've had a variety of conversations about this with people over the years, and it's always as if that's something massively, radically different, and it never is. It always feels a lot bigger than it really is. So I think the existing services, you know, it's never necessarily a good idea to invent something brand new. You need to get back and see what you're doing and what that can be doing better, that's actually probably including all of society instead of excluding, you know, people. So I would look at the existing structures that are in place and say, what can we do within those to make sure that they are actually, they've got the accessibility right, they're welcoming. I'm assuming they celebrate, you know, achievement. Are they celebrating disabled people's achievement? So they're, you know, putting that out in the community and saying, we are for you, come to us if you need support.
Yeah. Is there any good examples out there of where services have adapted to help young folk with this?
I can't think.
Not off the top of your head.
Can't think for that.
Maybe too difficult. Any, Oksana, Ashley, would you like to come in? Anything to add to what David said there?
I mean, we've had some good examples where clients have went into their own business, so they're doing things like virtual assistants, someone who had a fluctuating health condition that meant they weren't sure how they were going to be day to day, and that's about them understanding they could use access to work to come in and do some of that work. Dr. Danielle Farrell's a good example. She's got her own business and she uses that really, really effectively. And in some cases, I think it's about recognising the people who are role models for other young people who have done it themselves. We all know that how young people engage in something where they see someone that looks like them and what that means to them, and probably being able to showcase some of those good examples would be a great way for that young people, because if they're not thinking about employment as an option, they're certainly not thinking about self-employment as an option.
Sure. Oksana, do you have anything to add?
For people, young people with mental health issues, self-employment can be a bit of a challenge in itself. But I agree with Ashley and with David. Young people are very well influenced by their peers. So the more positive role modeling in terms of self-employment is out there, it would be really a big win.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Maggie Challenge, before by Margaret Fraser.
Thanks very much, Claire. Good morning to you all. Thank you for joining us today. I want to drill down. You've all touched on this in different ways, but we heard in the panel this morning from people representing LEPs and local authorities that they thought there were robust structures and processes in place regarding employability services for disabled people, and that capacity and funding, sustained funding and that kind of thing were the key issues in preventing us tackling the disability employment gap. I wonder, from what you've said already, I get the feeling that you don't think the employability system is working as well as it should. What, in your view, are there structures or process issues that we need to be thinking about to transform, to change, to get rid of, to replace, that mean that we can actually do what we all want to do and actually free you up to focus on supporting people into employment? Who wants to start? Ashley, go for it.
We have seen the greatest success where local authorities put investment. So what is challenging for us is the funding mechanisms are set up on an annual basis at the moment. So if someone's coming into a programme in 9 months, then the onus is on us as a third sector organisation to continue that support regardless of funding. And it's not about the amount of funding, it's about recognising that disability employment will not be done in 12 months, sadly. And we can invest in that in a multi-year structure that allows us to really heavily invest in things like aftercare. We've seen some real shifts where local authorities understand the need for aftercare, but when you're in an annual cycle of funding, the reality for them is they just can't go past that 12 months. And also recognising that qualified staff cost a bit more. You know, we have to be the biggest issue that we have at the moment is I'm signing up to the principles of fair work under my contracts, but I often cannot offer fair work to my own staff teams because contracts are coming out for 6 months or 3 months. Right. I'm not able to retain qualified staff. It takes, so all of our employment coordinators go through a supported employment PDA, yes, at HNC level. That's our commitment. They then go through NIDMAR. I know that you've, mm-hmm, seen some submissions around that. So we have a real commitment to providing qualified staff, but in a yearly contract cycle, they can't go through it in the first 6 months. You're only giving them 6 months to get through it, and then they're potentially moving on into other. So I guess for me, the structures around funding mechanisms and also recognising that qualified staff and what that costs, and that can also leads into the commissioning, the Procurement Act, where you can only commission up to a certain amount of the local authority, that also becomes challenging because it's not changed since 2014.
Okay. Thanks, Ashley. Oksana, do you have...
Be similar. Our most successful services are long-term funded services because if you support people with disability, you need time to develop this relationship. You need time to set up a business, the service, and then continue on improving on year on year. Working specifically with people with severe and enduring mental health issues, it does take time to be successful. But if this funding is arranged, then you'll see after year one, it's a very, very successful service. But unfortunately, going up and down in terms of funding, and the whole nervousness around, is it going to be extended or not, it does have a direct impact on behavior of people who are actually working in the service and also people who are using the service. It's not a really good thing. So for us, I think our collective ask has always been long-term funding, stable funding, so we can actually embed the service and keep improving it, keep delivering really good results.
David.
I agree with what's been said. I suppose the other thing I would say is our current structures ensuring that there is a wide enough range of specialist services that are actually required in areas. And one area I would highlight that hasn't been mentioned so far is employment services for people who have experienced sensory loss or were born deaf or blind. These types of services have fallen off a cliff.
They've literally disappeared. There's a little bit here and there across Scotland. Years ago, you had large national organisations who had teams of staff with specialist skills. It's pretty much gone. And there is an issue, and I think this is a particularly a local, as we go more local, this becomes an issue, where there's a thing about market stewardship, where you need to make sure that the market out there, everybody delivering, can actually deliver all the things that are needed. So you do need to have a bigger, more kind of strategic view of it. And I would say services for people who've experienced sensory loss, we try to do some work on that, but that's a particular issue at the moment. I know the Scottish Government were of the opinion, because we had some discussions with civil servants around about data for Fair Start Scotland, and they were kind of feeling as if there were people moving through that system and getting jobs. I'm not entirely sure. We certainly need more of that, and there'll be other specialist areas that you want to see. Obviously, people with learning disabilities, people with neurodivergence and things like that. There is, again, some parts of the country, lots happening. Other parts, there'll be tiny, tiny wee services.
That's interesting, and that leads me on to my next question, because I think, again, we heard this morning of you know, the desire to have an open for all, you know, come on, come all service that can then be made bespoke or tailored according to the individual's needs. Are you saying that actually we maybe need to be thinking more, we need to be thinking about different groups of disabled people and the needs they have, or is it about having the flexibility and agility within that?
You know, mainstream services that we call mainstream, you know, that kind of terminology, but they're not nearly as accessible as they should be. You know, they should be accessible anyway, and they should work for the vast, vast majority of people, and they might, you know, also for disabled people, and that'd be good. But there are specialists, you know, areas where you want to have a really important knowledge, particularly, I think, and not to say those services can't build that and, you know, develop that and develop their staff teams to do that. But, you know, I think if you're going out and you're doing supported employment for, let's say, someone who's sight impaired, you know, you want, and having conversations with employers, you want to be answering the detailed questions, really good knowledge about is there issues about technology, about accessibility and things like that. So these things are really important, and I think quite often people are muddling through.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's not good for anybody.
Yeah, so we heard a very clear example last week, a young person with vision impairment, and, you know, what you can and what screen readers can and can't read, and some things just, you know, it comes back to one of Ashley's earlier points about what people are doing. I suppose, Oksana or Ashley, do you have any comments about that tension between an inclusive for all disabled people employability service and the need for the bespoke tailoring of support?
I just want to make a point that when people gain employment, their journey just starts, really, and in-work support, ongoing in-work support is so, so important to help them to sustain, to retain their job, to get development in the job. And this is, again, relating to kind of the whole funding aspect. This funding should be available for a long time, because the person would need this support for a long time. If you are supporting a person with disability, there is a clear understanding that disability will not disappear.
Yeah.
This person will continue on being a disabled person, meaning will still need this support in work. Employers can present some challenges throughout the person's career. There might be, say, a line manager change. It's a huge change in the disabled person working life. Or there are some other things, or even some positive stressors, for example, a promotion. And it does require new reasonable adjustments, new support, and ongoing support is incredibly important.
Okay, thanks. Ashley?
Similar to what David had said, we've had to try and bring resource in to do the more specialists. So obviously Enable at its heart is a learning disability organisation. Enable Works delivers across disability and long-term health conditions. So we've actually started to train staff on BSL, but it takes a really long time to get staff trained on BSL. If you've only got a year funding, that's challenging. We've brought in a lot of work on assistive tech for people who have a visual impairment, but we've had to try and bring that specialism in, because we were getting, and it was similar to what David said, probably in the first wee while, we were muddling through and that's not an acceptable service for people.
Yeah.
So we've seen great strides forward in terms of closing the disability employment gap, but not for some of those key groups, not for people who have a learning disability. So there is a need for real specialism. But actually, being accessible can work for anyone who has a barrier to employment and making things as easy and accessible as possible. But we've seen real challenges, particularly, David had said, for those who have a hearing impairment or visual impairment. Okay. You know, interpreters, some upwards of £75 an hour. If your funding's for £50,000 a year, you just can't fund it. And what that leads an organisation to do is cherry-pick clients that are easier to move into work, and that's not at the basis of what we're trying to do here. Mm-hmm. So we have to be really clear on being able to fund things appropriately so that you're not having those young people experiencing a really negative, because we don't want someone to come in and have a bad experience with us, so we have to bring that specialism in.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. My final question, actually, you talked about the different structure that Dundee has, that you have in Dundee, and how that seems to work better than elsewhere. It's really, do you feel that there are opportunities for sharing kind of models or systems or examples of good practice of things that you know work, that and is there, do you find there's that people are willing to say, oh yeah, we can learn from that, how can we do something differently over here, sharing good practice, are there enough opportunities?
Probably space. Through the local authority, they certainly do a lot of sharing through things like Slade. So John Davidson, who's our contact in Dundee, does lots of that. He's really heavily involved in that. And we've seen some big strides forward. So through the National Conversations for No One Left Behind, we were part of that talking about our Glasgow model, which has 19 partners. And it's a little like David had said, we've brought in 19 partners who all have a different specialism. So there's no duplication. We all know exactly what we're doing. We know who's supporting who, but we have a really varied offer. So there has been better opportunities to share that. Where we've not probably got it right as a nation yet is understanding the nuances of rurality. So in a rural area, so we deliver a model in the Highlands of supported employment. We deliver it through the full local authority, right all the way up into Wick and across to Skye. The first year, I was a Glasgow girl who wrote a bid for the Highlands and had probably not spent enough time there. And the nuances and really understanding the challenges of rurality, there's not enough choice, there's not enough. So making sure that we have that spread, probably we're not sharing enough of that into areas of rurality would be the challenge.
Okay, thanks.
Ms Chapman, I want to make some progress. We're a bit short time and I've got a number of members. So Murdo Fraser, to be followed by Brian Buttle.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I just wanted to follow up on this question of funding and really ask you the same question I put to the earlier panel, if you were here, around funding for employability programmes, which is something that came up in the committee visit we did on Monday to Perth, to two social enterprises working with young people with autism and with learning difficulties. And the issue that came up there was around the lack of certainty around funding, where they weren't getting their award letters until well into the financial year. And if you heard the evidence from the previous panel, they confirmed that that was a pattern they were very familiar with. And according to the SPICE briefing we have for today's meeting, the Scottish Government's budget for the current year for employability is down 24% in real terms compared to last year. So I wondered if you, maybe Ashley, start with yourself, if you could say anything about the impact that's having in terms of your ability to deliver services and this issue around year-to-year funding and how that short-termism impacts on your ability to deliver.
Yeah, we ultimately have the greatest success in areas that commit to multi-year funding. They don't always have to commit to a level of budget. You know, we acknowledge that things change, but in Dundee, we are funded for the next 2 years. We were funded for the last 2 years. We have a lower turnover of staff, so we're able to keep really good, qualified, excellent staff, same in Edinburgh, same in Glasgow. The smaller local authorities have a challenge. They are not willing to take the same risks if they don't have their grant letters, and I can completely understand that. But we are losing qualified staff every day. And we are losing staff who've been in the sector for many years into other sectors, into other areas, because continuity of funding is a real problem. So I have to, as the director of EnableWorks, make a decision on balancing the risk of whether funding will come in again on a year, or do we put staff through redundancy processes. We've been in a really fortunate position because we've got flexibility of funding that I haven't had to make anyone redundant, and certainly in the 14 years I've been at Enable, we've never done that. But that's been as a decision as a charity to balance that risk rather than funding. And last year was particularly challenging because local authority letters came out very late. So most of the funding came out for 6 months. Some of the funding came out for 3 months. So if you're not funding, getting a bid out till September, I can't get started till December. What can I deliver in 3 months? Nothing of any real quality. So we had to make a decision not to go for those, which is a shame for the clients who ultimately don't get what we would deem a very good service.
Presumably, actually, you benefit from being part of a large national organisation which has reserves. So, you know, you're not necessarily reliant on that very short-term funding because you have something you can fall back on.
Yeah, I mean, we are very aware of the privilege that being a large organisation gives us, you know, and for some of our smaller partners, we've seen some employability organisations close. So RightTrack closed, they were part of our Glasgow partnership. They closed after 41 years, I think, they'd been in service for, as a result of changes to funding. The post-European funding, they were unable to manage the risk, and also the funding mechanisms of paying in arrears can be challenging as well, because if you pay quarterly in arrears and you have quite a big process to go through, sometimes you're not getting the funding for 5 months. That can be challenging if you're a small organisation.
Okay, thanks. Oksana?
We have a similar experience delivering a 12-month service in 6 months kind of period, and this year is going to be no different. We already have some indication that a couple of services we are delivering, and they are very important services for people with mental health issues, they are going to be closed because of the uncertainty with funding.
I don't have anything to add. Okay. I just think it's a point that's so obvious, and we've experienced it for many, many years, and the point has been made for years, and I don't understand why it hasn't been resolved. I do appreciate the budgeting pressures and things like that, but it stands to reason that the point has been made. If you want to build a team, if you want to build a presence in a community, if you want to build relationships with employers, with referral agencies, with education, with social work, with all the people, it makes sense that you can say, we're going to be here for 3 or 5 years. Mm-hmm. So,
okay, great. All right, thank you.
Infertile to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I'm just really trying to take on from what I was asking this morning around the employability services. Do we reach out? Is there enough of a reach out into the disabled community? Because, you know, we've heard, you know, from yourselves and from many other organisations some of this fantastic work that's been done, yet we have a comparatively high unemployment in our disability community. And we heard last week from some youngsters who got into employment and I got to really positive destinations about the journey. And you mentioned the journey that they go on, especially around, you know, neurological and learning difficulties, that journey. We heard about, you know, some of the difficulties at school and some of their experiences were not great. We also heard about experiences at DWP, you know, people wanting to help but not knowing quite how to help. And actually, it was by chance they got into, you know, a third sector organisation that was able to, you know, gather them and get them ready for employment. So I suppose, you know, it's around about that joined up thinking of the journey of all of our young people, but very specifically around our disability community. How do we, are we reaching into schools enough? Are we on the journey with them from an early enough stage? Ashley, I'll go to you.
Our challenges remain around funding in terms of how we fund as a government, in that young people who are in school sit under our education budget, and then our education and skills, young people in employment, they then go into a slightly different, and then young people who are disabled sitting in a social care budget, and sometimes those are not joined up enough, so it means that we have some challenges around being able to support someone all the way through their journey. So lots of the times it can be a funding mechanism, like David had said, our schools programme starts at 14. To me, a schools programme should start much, much earlier. But because of the nuances between it being an employability programme and not an education programme, it falls into a slightly different funding pot. But we should be reaching in much, much younger for young people. There have been really good strides forward, so things like developing young workforce, but they're term time programmes, so young people require support after. Out with term times, we do lots of work with young people in the summer. They're not independent travellers, so there's things that have to continue on through you know, through their journey, and actually a lot of the third sector is really well placed to deliver that support because they're a kind of tried, tested, usually community-based organisation that people know and trust, and they have a very different experience because it's not a statutory service.
So I suppose, Oxanne, just to develop that point, really, it's are schools aware enough of, you know, what's available to them? Are DWP, are employers aware, you know, of what's available to them to help our children through that journey?
I wouldn't say about schools in this respect, but since we are supporting people's mental health issues, young people come onto our services from CAMHS. So we have referrals from CAMHS, and we have a service specifically in Edinburgh, and it's very well regarded with excellent feedback service. So we work with CAMHS. This is where quite a lot of referrals are coming from. And I do feel there got to be a lot more done in raising awareness in schools and throughout the education sector.
David,
if you just I think I mentioned before about people having access to much better quality information, advice. Mm-hmm. I quite like the idea of independent brokerage for people, but that's a really, really old idea. Mm-hmm. But then there is no new ideas. You stood it about 30 years ago, we could actually go and talk to someone independent and talk about options, mm-hmm. and they had access to the knowledge and access. And then the disability employment advisors and job centres used to do something, you know, similar mm-hmm. to that as well. And they generally had a really good understanding of their area, you know, every, you know, be 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 in Glasgow, and they knew their patch, you know, in Partick or Maryhill and things like that. So there is a big issue, but I suppose moving with the times, that kind of advice and information, it needs to be in a language and a way presented to young people, makes sense to them. So presumably online and things like that, you know.
Just to try and draw a circle around that, we're really asking for more specialists. Employability services around the disability. Would that be fair? Is that a fair assumption?
Sorry, I'm not hearing you.
Looking for, you know, specialist employability services or more specialist employability services around our disability community. Is that a fair assessment?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener Randy. Good morning, panel, and thanks for your answers so far. I was really interested in the initial comments that you all made about sort of relationships with local employability partnerships. You know, you used language like inconsistent communication issues, engagement issues. I mean, why do you think that is, and how might we make that better?
32 local authorities. So obviously I'm not service delivery anymore, like colleagues here. But if you do, I mean, even if you're a national organisation, even if you're quite a significant, substantial national organisation with resource, trying to develop relationships, an understanding and knowledge about 32 different areas, that's a big, big undertaking. So it would naturally, what I think you will find is that you would maybe target some key areas for your business. You're going to do it for your business apart from anything else. Where you maybe already have a presence, so there'll be other places where you don't have much of a history as an organisation. Are you really going to go and try and invest in that area and have a presence, develop the relationships, with no great guarantee that it will lead to opportunities for your organisation? And then if it does lead to an opportunity, it might only be for a year. So, you know, you've got to think about it in those terms. So I think that is, you know, and you'll probably find, would it be the case that in some local authority areas, there will be a lot happening and a lot of people engaged, and then other local authority areas, mm-hmm. it won't be that many. So
it's inconsistent as well, because this is not these people's day jobs. They have other jobs to do. So we tend to find the local authority, like last year, some of the LEPs, the people there lost their job, and they had no consistent funding for them either. Therefore, the LEP just kind of fell apart in the last 3 months of the financial year. And as things change, you're not maybe getting a consistent membership of organisations like potentially like SDS or DWP as things have changed and shifted. And each local authority, so we're in 29 local authorities, and not one LEP is done the same. They're all done differently, mm-hmm. and their engagement is different. Their transparency, their kind of willingness to take feedback is all very different across every single one of them, but it's because it's an add-on to their all, what can also be a very complex job. So, you know, it's challenging to get the resource.
Yeah, it's kind of lack of standard approach, I suppose. You go into every of 32 local authorities and you would see a different setup, a different structure, different engagement lines, different communication appetite. And I think it just, kind of national approach, a local approach, both of them have their merits. But in terms of engaging these labs, you just need to work 32 times harder to engage with each.
One of the reasons why we've spoken about, and we started the conversation also talking about the support employment review. So if you're talking about support employment guarantee for people and you're talking about support employment quality standard, that would obviously apply across all 32 local authority areas. And it would be about ensuring that it didn't matter where you lived, you get a certain, at least minimum level of service available, and you knew it was going to be to a certain standard in every area. And that would go a long way, I think, to dealing with some issues of inconsistency.
Okay, thank you for that.
Thank you. Could I maybe just come back to why we're undertaking this inquiry? So the government have a commitment to halve the gap by 2038, and we know that some progress has been made. Do you have confidence, Ashley, I'll come to first, that we're on the right track to meet that target? Because looking at some of the evidence that we've been provided with, so if you were to focus on education just and have disabled people reaching the same standard of education in general, that would just be a 4% we managed to close. If we were to look at structural barriers and do something significant there, that would be 28 percentage points. Do you think we have a clear path to 2038 and that target is going to be met?
Probably not. In some cases, I think that there has been strides forward for certain key groups under the disability employment gap, but for some of those groups, so particularly people who have a learning disability, like David covered in terms of people who have a visual impairment or hearing impairment, we're not making the same strides forward for that group. So while we've closed the gap by, I think, about 7% since in the last couple of years, those groups are not getting better. So, you know, learning disability rate's about 5%. It hasn't improved. And actually, if we're kind of failing that key cohort of people, then we're not going to close the gap enough because it's not a level playing field for everyone. And actually, similar to what David had said earlier, we also need to stop people leaving the workplace. So more work and support around recognising people who are in work. How do we keep them in work? How do we keep people healthy? How do we tie in things like health and wellbeing to work and what that means? Trying to get rid of some of the stigma around disability and doing that sort of work as well. But until we get some of those structures right, we're not going to close that gap for some of those key cohorts.
The No One Left Behind funding and model of delivery is sufficient or is informed enough on what the structural barriers and what the challenges are to help us get there? Or do you think we need to look more closely at maybe how that's been delivered? Or do you think the learning partnerships, the local authority partnerships, recognise where you've maybe got the biggest challenges in closing the gap?
I think in terms of the local authority partnerships, we've seen some strides, but again, unless we're going to invest in specialist support, the one-size-fits-all hasn't worked for people who are disabled in Scotland. And equally, until we move, the principles of No One Left Behind are how third sector organisations operate every day. It's about person-centred support, it's quality-driven, it's, you know, flexible, and it's local delivery. All of those principles are great, but without correct investment in that support, we're not going to make strides forward, or continued commitment to that support, then we're not going to make the strides forward. But ultimately, the principles of No One Left Behind, third sector organisations have been delivering those principles for many, many years.
Mm-hmm. Kevin Short, do you want to go?
Thank you, Vina. Ashley, you mentioned a diverse workforce. And in the previous panel, I talked about diverse jobs that we now have requiring a diverse workforce. What would you do to persuade employers that it is the right thing for them to do to employ disabled people, learning disabled people, and people who are neurodiverse? What would be your message to them?
we talk to a lot of employers about the economic benefit. You have to be able to talk business language. They have to see the economic benefit in having a diverse workforce. We've seen massive strides forward, actually, with our employer engagement in the last year. I think it's because they're recognising that they are working, particularly things like food and drink, tech. We're seeing massive strides forward in finance, where they recognise that they need a skill set that they're not attracting at the moment, particularly skill sets that have ageing workforces, big skills gaps. But we have to provide them qualified staff to be able to go into that. So, you know, sector-based academies are a great example of where a disabled person can come in and have the skills required. But actually, we have seen some big strides forward in some of the big national employers. But really, it's about the economic benefit. You cannot afford not to do this, because ultimately, the 18 to 30-year-olds are four times less likely to apply to an organisation that does not support their diversity needs. So they can't afford not to do this. And I think that's the conversation we need to start having with businesses.
Oksana, please.
I think we need to give employers confidence that with the right support, they can engage with workforce which they are not engaging just now, with people fully, I mean, as people with disabilities, and ensure that they do understand the kind of the concept of reasonable adjustments and all the support the providers like ourselves can give to them to be successful in engaging with people who have disabilities. And I think this is really what is working. Our practice shows that we engage with employers on day-to-day basis. And when we work through initial difficulties, after that, in work support is quite straightforward. But to overcome this initial engagement, set up a person in a job and then support them, I think if you give this confidence to the employers that this support will be available for both the employee and themselves, is one of the key factors in success.
Thank you. David, please.
We need to do a lot more work with employers. Ashley made the point about the business case. That is the language that needs to be used. It does need to make sense for people. People want to do the right thing. They don't know how to do the right thing, and they're afraid of doing the wrong thing. They're afraid of a really awkward situation where they're bringing people into their organisation and they can't properly support them. Mm-hmm. So there is a real need for investment in that area, or at the very least, encouraging employers to do that investment for themselves. Mm-hmm. One of the things that came out of the public social partnership and our recommendation going back to government is we would like to see a centre of excellence for Scotland's employers, and it's a place where they can go and access the wealth of specialist knowledge and information that exists, and mentoring, support, training, consultancy. There's an enormous resource in Scotland to assist employers. They don't know it's there, they don't know what they need, they don't know the benefits it could bring them. I don't incidentally think that's something the taxpayer should pay for, because I think if most employers are private sector, should the taxpayer pay for private sector employers to become, you know, more diverse? I think they should be looking to make investments there themselves, you know. But I think the government could maybe pump prime some of that to kind of establish that kind of institution.
So forgetting tick box exercises, because I kind of abide them, mm-hmm. Do you think that it would be wise to establish a scheme? For example, I'm a carer positive employer. Would it be wise to establish a scheme, not a tick box scheme, for employers to award employers who are positive towards employing people who are diverse?
Yeah, a properly accredited scheme, properly measured, that actually did offer a proper insight into what happens inside that organisation. And it's perfectly possible, but it would need to look at, you know, mm-hmm. how you're recruiting people, how you're supporting people. You know, if you've got a high number of people leaving your organisation every year, that's telling us something. How are you addressing that kind of thing? But yeah, people like prizes and medals, so why not?
They do.
But it needs to be real, and the kind of current ones aren't really real, are they?
No. If you look at you're a disability confident leader, you should be a leader in your field. And absolutely, that is not the case in most cases. And it should be difficult to get, because you should be aspiring to being a leader and what that means, and you should be accountable to that. So I'd love to see a huge overhaul of something like a disability confidence scheme, where actually it's assessed independently, where you're not just saying, oh, I do this, and no one actually evidences whether I do it or not. And it might be that you've never hired a disabled person in your life, and you could be a disability confident leader.
Yeah.
So if you're a leader, you should be someone that's, you know, and that should be invested in. So absolutely.
Can I add a point on that? I was at a thing recently where Strathclyde University presented on this, and they had done research into this. And at the three different levels for disability confident, they looked at the proportion of the workforce who are disabled. Mm-hmm. There was absolutely no difference whatsoever between having it and not having it. And I think at Leader, it was actually 0.1% lower if you had it rather than not having it. It's made no difference whatsoever. So that kind of accreditation, not... Proper accreditation, proper standards, yes.
Oksana, do you have anything
to
add?
I just want to agree with both Ashley and David. The arrangement is already there. It just needs to be real, as opposed to what we have just now.
Get rid of the tick box and make sure that folk are actually living
up
to it.
It's a declaration. It's a declaration. It's not measurement of factors or achievements. So you can declare your disability positive, and that's it.
Thank you very much, folks. Thank you, convener.
Just before we close, could I maybe ask a question about supported workplaces? So when we came to Dundee last year and we visited Enable, we also went to Dovetail Enterprises. So while I think this morning we've talked more about employers and people moving into employment and being supported into employment, I don't know if anyone wants to say anything about the role of supported workplaces like Dovetail, that and then we visited, as other people have said, we visited Push Recycling and the Giraffe Cafe, which maybe they are workplaces where the support, that's the purpose, kind of thing. You understand the distinction I'm making. But maybe, David, do you want to come in first? Because you represent supported employment, which I don't know if that includes supported workplaces as well as...
Sort of. Supported workplaces have always been quite controversial in our sector because sometimes people see them as being a ghetto almost, where people go and never leave. Some of our members operate supported workplaces. We believe very much in the supported employment model. We are the keepers of the flame for that, and that's what we promote. I suppose what you could say, I mean, there's maybe not an awful lot of difference between a supported workplace in some cases and someone else might just call a social enterprise, a cafe or something like that. I think the thing about it is it a throughput for people that then moves them out into open employment in the wider economy? And sometimes it's actually quite challenging because people don't want to, because where they are is really nice and they like it and fully understand why that would be the case. So it is... I'm choosing my words carefully. It is part of the landscape. I don't think it's going anywhere. And we need to make sure that it is utilised effectively to ultimately move more disabled people into work, but probably in the wider economy.
Mm-hmm. And maybe ask you a question that's linked to that, about how the government's target into employment, is that... which is a legitimate target, it's the one we're scrutinising, but does that maybe not recognise that some people employ... You know, yesterday, when we met young people yesterday, some people were in volunteering work. That was where they felt... I mean, I asked if they wanted to move into paid employment. They felt the volunteering role suited them more in the circumstances they were in. Some, you know, was HOD organisers say to us, sometimes it's just about increasing somebody's confidence and their life skills. It's not always about employment. So do you think we're measuring enough, or we're measuring the right things?
I think we should also make sure that people are sustaining going into employment, and that would be a greater focus for us. We placed almost 1,100 people into work last year, and 87% of them sustained to 6 months. We are now going to track them to 2 years, because there is no point in putting someone into work if they just go into a hamster wheel and they drop in and out. And young people and adults need to be able to make an informed choice about work. So for lots of our young... I met a young person who'd been working in Burger King for 15 years, and when I asked him if he'd been paid, he said no. Burger King can absolutely afford to pay a young person to be in work. So yes, we'd absolutely see volunteering as an option, but some of that is around the informed choice about permitted work under their benefits and making sure that they, and for me, work is not about full-time and part-time, 16 and 35 hours, you know, 17 and a half, 35 hours. It's about what someone can contribute, but equally that is meaningful. But we should be tracking sustainment into work rather than just people at the point of them going into work. We don't track volunteering as an employability outcome as an organisation because we are very heavily focused on the principles of fair work, putting someone into a good job. We believe that everyone has the ability to go into a job that is high quality and well paid, and we see volunteering as a gateway to that. Mm-hmm. So when we look at young people leaving school, we don't count volunteering in our schools programme as an outcome because it doesn't is an outcome that's not going to lead them in necessarily right away into a well paid job, but it is definitely a gateway to a job. But some of that kind of issues with young people thinking about is about that thing about permitted work. Can I do that? How will that impact my benefits? How will that impact my life moving forward? And if you're going into a low paid entry level job, in some cases you are absolutely not in a better off position, and that's a really difficult position for young people to think about.
Oksana, is there anything you want to add on?
Yeah, I agree, and I think it's really from our point of view, we feel that supported businesses are all supported placements or supported businesses. There is absolutely a place for them. But for us, we are advocating for competitive employment, independent employment, when people go into employment, and supported in employment to develop their skills and get trained. So it's kind of place and train model, which is the principle of supported employment. So in that, that's kind of our position that we feel is the most rewarding. And permitted work is absolute key to start on the career path and then potentially build the hours and then see what's going to happen next. But permitted work is an absolute key in this journey.
Yeah, thank you very much all for giving evidence this morning. I'll now move into private session.